good morning, everyone. Welcome to See Today's morning program right here. This is the See Morning Show. As always, for the next 3 hours, we're going to give you the latest updates. It's what's happening across the globe and especially right here in our nation. Our top stories are still right here in regards to the natural disaster with all the volcanoes that is erupting right here in Asia. And we are still updating you on the latest from the Gaza Strip on the conflict that is ongoing between Israel and also with the Palestine Hamas. With that said, welcome to the Friday morning right here for the See Morning Show. My name is Caroline Sarahman. I am not alone. Of course, we have my colleagues right here for our Friday squad. We have Archie Paramesuera and also Sarah Wayne. Hi, how are you guys? Good morning.
Good morning.
We're coming into the first weekend post-Eid holiday.
Yeah.
Yes. And the traffic has now returned to Jakarta, so welcome back traffic and welcome back work days as well.
That's right.
Yes. We need to get productive and ready to be facing the traffic.
Yes.
All right, folks, good morning, good morning. I'm your host, Archie, and in addition to what Carol just said, we also have special talk shows. And today, we have a talk show with a doctor, and we're going to talk about the danger of vaping. So make sure you stay tuned for that. And as always, you can connect with us on our social media at See Today News on Instagram, X, and also YouTube.
And I'm Sarah Wayne. I would like to greet our viewers that are now able to tune in from Foxtel's Flash Australia, Macau Cable TV Channel 84, Vision Philippines Channel 58, Air Cable Philippines, and Singtel Singapore Channel 15, and StarHub Channel 720. All right, now let's begin the show with our headlines for today.
All right, thank you, Sarah. For our first headline, police officers in Dubai rescues a cat during an unprecedented rainstorm. The United Arab Emirates tried to wrung itself out after the heaviest recorded rainfall ever to hit the country.
Malaysia Airlines and AirAsia have canceled flights to Sabah and Sarawak following the eruption of Mount Ruang in North Sulawesi, Indonesia.
Lahar flows from Mount Semeru has displaced hundreds in Lumajang region.
And Indonesian, aren't we proud, as Indonesia made history after defeating Australia 1-0 in the second match of the Group A of the 2024 AFC Under-20 Asian Cup. And definitely one of our discussion today is about Eid holiday blues. So you're mentioning about the traffic, you were mentioning next week everything has to be on top notch when we're going to be, it's the first Monday next week, right? This week it doesn't necessarily count
yet.
Yes. Exactly, right? So we're going to have that all on our See Morning Show today. So right now we're going to be highlighting on an issue right here in Jakarta where firefighters were battling a blaze at a store in South Jakarta last night in a race to save workers believed to be trapped inside.
Strong winds fanning the flames were complicating the effort.
Five other workers were rushed to the hospital after escaping the burning building, but not without getting injured in the process. The Mampang Prapatan police are investigating the fire.
Masih terkini, yang berhasil sudah diselamatkan korban ada 5 orang yang merupakan seluruhnya karyawan. Info sementara yang kami terima masih ada beberapa korban lagi yang terperangkap di dalam. Kami masih upayakan maksimal untuk pemadaman, pendinginan, dan kami akan upayakan untuk evakuasi.
Lahar flow from Mount Semeru has displaced hundreds in the Lumajang Regency.
Thursday's flow, triggered by hours of heavy rain, also destroyed bridges connecting 4 districts. The affected are residents of villages along 3 local rivers, Rajali, Glidik, and Mujur. There were close to a dozen tremors detected as well.
And elsewhere in Banten, the overflow from Lake Cilumbun has affected dozens of homes and left streets waterlogged with water levels reaching a meter in some parts. The affected has evacuated to higher grounds. Now, in regards to what Archie has mentioned before with Mount Semeru, actually, the last recorded activity of Mount Semeru has occurred on March 28, 2024, so it's just a couple of weeks ago. Now, they have already seen propelling hot clouds, flowed by lava flow, visual monitoring, observed white gray smoke in the main crater with a height of 50 to 300 meters. Now, the geological agency still maintains the activity status of Mount Semeru at level 3, or with additional recommendation to adjust the potential threat of danger. Now, we know that in North Sulawesi right now, there are some activities with the mountains, and it seems that it's propelling seismic activation throughout all these volcanic mountains throughout Indonesia.
Yes, and that's very important for us as well, because as we all know, Indonesia is located under the Ring of Fire. So we have to be able to take mitigation and steps taken if these activities continue to rise, especially the residents living near these mountains.
That's right.
And we now move on where authorities have also raised alarm after Mount Gamalama in Ternate also began showing increased activities as well.
Where volcano monitor PVMBG reported Thursday of a thick column of white smoke coming from the crater, sometimes reaching 100 meters high, that began the day before.
The agency also detected over two dozen earthquakes and a swarm of minor ones lasting between around 7 to 17 seconds each. Though the volcano's alert level remained the same, officials warned that the area 1.5 kilometers from it is considered unsafe.
Kemarin dari pukul 18 di jam 6 sorean waktu Indonesia Timur, Gamalama mengalami peningkatan kegempaan, terutama di kelembaban busanya. Kemarin sampai terjadi sekitar 100 lebih kejadian untuk gempa embusan, terus terjadi juga kegempaan vulkaniknya. Itu mengindikasikan bahwa ada aktivitas dari magmanya di dalam tubuh gunung api Gamalama seperti itu. Makanya kita mengeluarkan warning untuk terjadi peningkatan kegempaan, perlu ditingkatkan kewaspadaannya.
In our following news, we've been updating on what is happening right now in the United Arab Emirates itself after they ring itself out Thursday after the heaviest recorded rainfall ever to hit the desert nation, with its main airport allowing more flights.
The flooding sparked speculation that the UAE's aggressive campaign of cloud seeding, flying small planes through clouds dispersing chemicals aimed at getting rain to fall, may have contributed to the deluge.
However, experts say that the storm systems that produced the rain were forecasted well in advance and that cloud seeding alone would not have caused such flooding.
Not only rescuing people, police officers in Dubai rescued a cat during an unprecedented rainstorm that hit the United Arab Emirates. The black and white cat was seen clinging to the handle of a car in flood water on Wednesday. By the end of Tuesday, more than 142 millimeters or 5.5 inches of rainfall had soaked Dubai over 24 hours. The UAE's drainage systems quickly became overwhelmed, flooded out neighborhoods, business districts, and even portions of the 12-lane Sheikh Zayed Road highway running through Dubai. Dubai International Airport, the world's busiest for international travel, has allowed global carriers to again fly into Terminal 1 at the airfield. However, Dubai Airport CEO Paul Griffiths said that the airfield needed at least another 24 hours to resume operations close to its usual schedule. The airport ended up needing 22 tankers with vacuum pumps to get water off its grounds.
The real issues, I think, started on Tuesday when the storm cells came across from Saudi Arabia, and we were looking at the radar thinking, goodness, if this hits, then it's going to be cataclysmic, and indeed it was.
Long-haul carrier Emirates, crucial to east-west travel, has begun allowing local passengers to arrive at Terminal 3, their base of operations.
When, of course, the check-in moratorium expired, that's when everyone came to the airport in an attempt to get on flight. So I think we had more than 2,000 people in T3 getting to rebook their flights and getting checked in and away. I was there about 12 p.m. today, and it was extremely busy, but I think the customers were, you know, good-humoured. They accept the situation. They realise that we can't control the weather.
Emirates, whose operations had been struggling since the storm Tuesday, had stopped travelers flying out of the UAE from checking into their flights as they tried to move out connecting passengers. Pilots and flight crews also had a hard time reaching the airport given the water on the roadways. On Thursday, Emirates lifted that order to allow customers into the airport. That saw some 2,000 people come into Terminal 3, again sparking long lines. Some travelers who arrived in Dubai describe hours-long waits to get their baggage, with some just giving up to head home or to whatever hotel would have them.
The
And we move on to other news. Scaling up assistance in Gaza remains a challenge in the face of continued access denials, delays, and other impediments.
According to United Nations News, between 6th until the 12th of April, 41% of humanitarian requests to the north were denied.
A UN convoy also came under crossfire while near a checkpoint during the same period. The following is the story of how food has been so scarce in the Gaza Strip.
Scores of Gazans stood in line to get boxes of aid in the central city of Deir al-Balah in the Gaza Strip on Thursday. They need to wait in days after they registered their names to get food months ago.
أنا والله جاية فجأة سجلت بالمدرسة من قيمة شهرين جاية فجأة بطلع على الأسماء لقيت اسمي موجود يعني أنا فرحت لما لقيت اسمي موجود أخذت الكرتون.
Large numbers of food parcels were handed over to displaced Palestinians who queued up outside UNRWA school that now houses the offices of charity.
بالنسبة لأن أنا أقدر أوفر قوت يومي صعب جدا بالنسبة لأسعار صار غالية لأنت رح تشتري سعر غالي يعني فوق الخيال يعني مش نسبة مثلا نقول 2% غلا 10% قول 300% شو هذا مش قادر نشتري أدنى حاجة أشتريها للأولاد صغار ما قادر أشتريها بسكوت في التمر هذا أشتري للولد عندي 5 صنفار بدي ما يقارب كل يوم 27 شيكل بس بسكوت تمر طب هو قاعد بيع كابونات مش قادر أشتري أنا مش قادر أخذ كابونتي
The humanitarian situation in the Gaza Strip now is as catastrophic as ever. The northern part of the coastal region has been struck with severe shortage of food, with famine said that to be imminent in the hard-hit north. Aid has struggled to reach the area because of the fighting, forcing many displaced Palestinians to the south of Gaza.
ما عندناش دخل ثابت ما فيش من أولادي ولا واحد متوظف ولا جوزي متوظف كلهم عمال وبما إن هلقيت إحنا هنا في الجنوب ما فيش دخل مادي يعني بنوفر حاجات يعني بسيطة للأطفال يعني بخص عليهم بمرقوا عن العصير بدنا عصير يا ستي بدنا عصير يا ماما بدنا بسكوتات بدنا لو طلع كابونة وفيها شوية حلاوة فيها شوية عصير بطيروا من الفرحة عليها لأنهم محرومين وهذا طبعا إحنا مش قادرين نوفر لهم
Food has been scarce in the strip since Israel's offensive that has caused widespread devastation and killed over 33,800 people.
Now moving on to other international news, as two jurors in former President Donald Trump's hush money trial were dismissed Thursday, one after expressing doubt about her ability to be fair and impartial, and the other over concerns that some of his answers in court may not have been accurate.
The dismissals reduced to 5 the number of jurors who have been seated for the first ever criminal trial of a former president.
The setback in the selection process emerged during a frenetic morning in which prosecutors also asked for Trump to be held in contempt over a series of social media posts this week. The judge in the case barred reporters from identifying jurors' employers after expressing privacy concerns.
It has been a tumultuous third day of jury selection in Donald Trump's hush money criminal trial. The day began with 7 seated jurors, but now there are just 5. 2 jurors were dismissed after being seated and sworn in. The first, a nurse from Manhattan who said that she feared she could not be impartial or fair, could not keep the outside influences out of her judgment of the case after people started reaching out and asking if she was on the jury. She was concerned about identifying information about her making its way to the media and being able to identify her. Jurors in this case are anonymous for the most part. The parties have the names, Donald Trump has the names, but the rest of the world does not know who these people are. Then, later in the day, a second juror was dismissed. This man, an IT professional, had said during questioning that he found Donald Trump mysterious and fascinating, but prosecutors raised questions about whether he had honestly answered a question about having in the past been accused or convicted of a crime. Prosecutors said they found a news article about a man with the same name who had been arrested in the 1990s for tearing down political posters in the New York City suburbs. After a conference in court where the man was brought back to the courthouse to answer questions, he was dismissed from the jury as well. Adding to that, more drama in the courtroom. Prosecutors are again seeking to hold Donald Trump in contempt of court. They have cited 7 social media posts that he has made since the court began on Monday that they want to add to a hearing next week where they seek to have Donald Trump fined at least $3,000 and possibly face additional sanctions. Also, the judge, in light of what has happened to these two jurors and identifying information possibly getting out into the public, he has ordered the media to stop reporting the specific names of potential jurors' employers and previous employers. And since he made that order, people who have been interviewed for the jury pool, in the jury box, potential jurors, they have been talking about their employment in more generic terms, working in finance, in banking, as a lawyer, but not identifying which law firm or which bank.
Neville, this is not something new or uncommon for Donald Trump. We know during his presidency or wherever, he's always on the social media. And if he is elected once again as the president or as the POTUS, definitely we're going to see more of this. Now, if I just want to refresh your mind of what are now the cases or the court cases against Donald Trump. Well, Trump has pleaded guilt or not guilty to 34 counts of falsifying business records related to $130,000 payment made to adult film actor Stormy Daniels at the end of 2016 election cycle to keep her quiet about her allegation that she and Trump has a sexual encounter. Definitely Trump had denied this affair. But right now from the political realm, we know 5th of November is going to be the presidential election for United States. As of right now, the strong contender, both from Democratic and also Republican, is President Joe Biden and the former Donald Trump. Hence, I said right now, if we're going to see the polls, the statistic, Biden right now holding a slim point lead of 50% to 48% of Donald Trump. So that is just, it's just a slid by, right? So, and definitely right now, people in the United States, you know, the citizens right now are, I think they're in like a jumble, like they don't know, like as of right now, for 4 years, President Joe Biden has not been, it seems like right now, like for the past 4 years, a lot of the Black Americans or, you know, the communities, other minority communities are backing him up now in regards to what's happening in Gaza and especially in the Middle East. Those voters are kind of shifting now towards Donald Trump. And what is so funny right now, while older voters and college-educated white voters, men in particular, are moving heavily in Biden's direction where it was more to Donald Trump's camp before. So this kind of dynamic is going to be, you know, it's going to be very exciting for us to see, especially coming up to November.
Well, yes.
You're right?
Right.
Okay. And now after seeing what is happening in the courtroom, of course, as you said before, is not Donald Trump without all the drama. So
that's right.
We'll be waiting for that. We'll be rooting for that.
It's
as well.
His remarks, right?
Yes. Like you're waiting and his comments. His and just because of just like this with the courtroom itself, he has said that he is spending too much time in the courtroom when he's actually can be using the time to go travel to other states for his political campaign.
That's right.
So we'll wait for that. And now next we have to take a short break, but stay with us on the C Morning Show because when we come back, we have news from all around Indonesia.
Kayaknya lucu juga nih kalau dapur kita kasih warna, nggak cuma warna coklat, warna putih, yang ternyata emang berhasil naikin mood rumah ini sih.
Untuk jendela, pintu, dan furniturnya semuanya harus simple dan minimalis.
Kalau misalnya bolongannya dari utara, itu pasti lebih banyak angin yang masuk.
Ready to score a touchdown?
Oh, I was born ready.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Go.
Morning
gue yang penting apa yang gue makan bisa gue buang pada saat gue olahraga gitu.
Jadi Abila kalau ketemu mungkin dia ketawa gitu.
Dengan proses gue bersyukur banget Kubu Junior tuh sempat bubar tahun 2016-2017.
Pilihnya sabu-sabu karena sabu-sabu kita cuma makannya setahun sekali.
Kalau kita dengerin Spotify ya, Pak gimana sih caranya aku bisa masuk di sini gitu. Ya nggak boleh menghalangi lah.
The Indonesian State-Owned Enterprises Ministry has underlined its commitment to supporting small and medium enterprises by launching vending machines at Soekarno-Hatta International Airport.
Qatar has advanced to the quarterfinals of the 2023 AFC Asian Cup after defeating Palestine 2-1 in the round of 16 at the Al Ayed Stadium in Al-Khor.
So we'll be back with the Danny Desert Entertainment.
See Indonesia, see the world, see you today.
Selamat malam pemirsa See You Today. Kita ketemu lagi di Ngonten, ngobrolin tentang Nusantara.
Jadi gandrong gandring, Chris empuk gandring.
Iya, itu dia.
Chris empuk gandring. Ah, ini.
Dari mana? Kira menurut kamu ini daerah mana? Dari daerah mana? Dari negara lain ini?
Malaysia.
Dari China? India.
Asia Tenggara aja boleh gak? Namanya See You Today. See You Today Southeast Asian.
This is the situation at kilometer 414.
This morning experienced the crossing situation from Bakaheni, Lampung to Merak, Banten. And we didn't experience any traffic from Bakahuni until we arrived in Merak, Banten.
Jasa Marga predicts the peak of return flow on Eid al-Fitr celebration takes place on April 15, 2024.
Folks, welcome back to the program. As previously mentioned by Sarah, we have our local updates in the segment. We begin with our first story where five are behind bars with three others being sought after a recent drug bust at Soekarno-Hatta Airport.
Speaking in a briefing Thursday, Deputy Director of the National Police's Narcotics Division, Senior Commissioner Ari Ardian, told the press that the syndicate recruited two airline employees at Medan's Kuala Namu to help a courier board undetected.
The courier was arrested at Soekarno-Hatta last March with 5 kilograms of meth and thousands of ecstasy pills were seized.
Dari hasil penangkapan tersebut, kita mengembangkan adanya keterlibatan dari karyawan atau petugas lavatory service salah satu maskapai penerbangan, saya singkat dengan L, di mana kedua petugas karyawan ini mengambil barang dari luar dan dimasukkan ke area bandara. Setelah itu yang bersangkutan bertemu dengan tersangka MR yang berangkat dari Medan Kuala Namu, ya, masuk tanpa melalui jalur pemeriksaan barang. Tanpa melalui proses scanner.
Moving on, within the last 4 months, Lebak Regency in Banten recorded more than 1,400 cases of dengue fever, including 6 casualties. The cases are spread in most areas of the Regency.
The local government, through the Lebak Regency Health Authority, has set an endemic status to the area due to the rampant cases of dengue fever.
The rapid rise of the cases prompted Lebak's deputy region to issue notices to each district to be on the alert.
The authority has carried out several programs, starting from giving out information at local health facilities to conducting fogging programs in an effort to decrease the number of cases.
Dinas Kesehatan juga sudah memprogramkan beberapa sosialisasi di tingkat puskesmas, kemudian memberikan apa ada program logging ya, logging yang memang sebenarnya masih ada teknologi-teknologi yang lain yang juga bisa lebih tepat atau lebih pas gitu, tapi memang itu sudah teranggarkan, logging itu juga salah satunya untuk mencegah.
Chinese Foreign Minister Wang Yi is scheduled to visit Labuan Bajo on Friday.
And several security precautions within the area have been conducted by personnel of the Joint Security Team.
Preparations for the Chinese foreign minister's visit has begun since Thursday morning at West Manggarai Police Headquarters. More than 300 joint personnel from the armed forces and police are on standby, as well as several supporting agencies.
Security will be focused at a number of spots, such as Komodo Airport, Labuan Bajo Harbor, Padar Island, and the hotel. As for the delegates and guests, security escorts will be conducted starting from Thursday afternoon until April the 20th.
Posko kita, posko pengamanan yang di yang sudah kita setting sebelum-sebelumnya, yaitu untuk memantau dari setiap titik pengamanan, ya, mulai dari bandara, masuk kendaraan dari bandara, jalur-jalur sampai mereka dikawal sampai dengan masuknya hotel, terus nanti dari hotel ke venue di mana delegasi kita maupun delegasi RRC untuk melakukan pertemuan bilateral meeting.
Now news from the Indonesian Air Force is Colonel Ardi Syahri is now the Air Force's new information chief.
Yes, he is replacing Air Commander Bambang Yuniar, who assumes command of Adi Sumarmo Air Base.
And on the welcoming ceremony on Thursday, Colonel Ardi had highlighted his agenda in building strong connection with the media and social media platforms as his priority.
This, he believed, will support and promote the programs laid out by new Air Force Chief, Air Chief Marshal Tony Harjono.
His first major task will be the coverage of the Air Force's 78th anniversary celebration in Yogyakarta.
Yang terpenting adalah dari Kasau itu kita harus membuka komunikasi strategis dengan para media sosial, para kru untuk apa ya, membuka silaturahim dalam rangka mengekspos TNI Angkatan Udara ke depan. Ya, utamanya untuk setelah menjadikan TNI Angkatan Udara itu disegani di kawasan, ini sekarang Kasau yang baru mencetuskan program ampuh, ya, ampuh. Nah, inilah ke depan program yang akan saya akan.
And next up, Idul Fitr is just not a celebration for the people, it is a celebration for all living things. This includes livestock in the slopes of Mount Merapi, Boyolali, Central Java.
Cattle and goats are adorned with ketupat necklaces and paraded around villages in a tradition known as the Eid of the Cow. Let's check this out.
Locals in Dukuh Mlambong Village, Boyolali, Central Java celebrate Eid al-Fitr with a unique tradition of bakdan sapi. The rites saw residents gathering and bringing food, especially the traditional rice cake of ketupat, for a communal prayer and meal known as Kenduri Kembul Bujono.
Arak-arakan sapi ini merupakan tradisi tahunan yang sudah dilaksanakan sejak zaman dahulu. Jadi setiap tahun, khususnya pada hari ke-8 bulan Sawal, itu diadakan tradisi arak-arakan sapi. Maksudnya untuk memeriahkan Lebaran, ya, untuk mengisi bulan Sawal, dan tujuannya yaitu untuk meningkatkan persatuan dan kesatuan.
After having meals, residents adorn their cattle and goats with ketupat before parading them through the streets, joining with others from the village. The tradition emphasizes the importance of family and communal ties. And the highlight of the event is the parade of hundreds of cows down the village's main road. It is led by a pile of vegetables accompanied by the traditional reog topeng ireng dance.
Istilahnya kalau orang Jawa sini dipercaya membawa berkah, tapi cepat bunting, cepat beranak, sehat-sehat semua.
Relying on dairy and breeding cows as a primary source of income for generations, the locals see the tradition as a way to express gratitude for the blessings of nature. The gunungan, or a pile of crops, is shared among residents, and some contents are given to feed the cows, believed to bring prosperity and abundance to the cattle. The tradition is believed to improve the cattle's growth and productivity, ensuring the plentiful milk from dairy cows and healthy offspring from the breeding cows. See to the contributor, reporting from Boyolali, Central Java.
All right, folks. So right now we're going to have a quick break. And after the break, we'll have Carol set to bring you some sports updates. So Carol, what do you have for us today?
Definitely all the Indonesians are having the Garuda in dadaku, definitely, with Indonesia had won against Australia for the AFC Under 23 Asian Cup. We also have from Stuttgart Open from the world of tennis, and definitely we know the NBA regular season is almost coming to an end. Play-in's last final game will be today on Friday, and we're going to go all bang with the playoffs. So we have that and more to come right here on the Sea Morning Show. Sports is coming up next.
Welcome to City Day Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
City Day Business.
Figur publik kok kere. Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Harus setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya gitu, bikin...
Bikin pesawat
gitu.
Sim salabim.
Abrakadabra.
Singgobangkosir.
Pala botak gak bisa disisir.
Pala botak gak bisa.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga. Indonesia!
Come see the nature, only on Sea Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on Sea Indonesia.
Only on Sea Indonesia.
The Indonesian State-Owned Enterprises Ministry has underlined its commitment to supporting small and medium enterprises by launching vending machines at Soekarno-Hatta International Airport.
Qatar has advanced to the quarterfinals of the 2023 AFC Asian Cup after defeating Palestine 2-1 in the round of 16 at the Al Ayed Stadium in Al-Khor.
So we'll be back with the Danny Desert Entertainment.
See Indonesia, see the world, see you today.
Kenapa nama Thai PG ini berdiri? Kalau bahasa kayak kita tuh nama panggilannya tuh lebih gampang tuh panggil Aji tuh Thai PG. Thai PG itu kan panggil tuh Mak Gendut. Resepnya turun menurun. Nah, sedangkan saya baru ke generasi kedua.
Welcome back to the program. As mentioned before, yes, we do have our sports update in this segment. We begin with Indonesia, where they made history after defeating Australia 1-0 in the second match of Group A of the 2024 AFC Under 23 Asian Cup at Abdullah bin Khalifa Stadium, Doha, on Thursday. Now, these young Garuda team won thanks to a single goal by Komang Teguh Trisnanda in the 45th minute. The Borneo FC player scored the goal with a header after defeating Nathan Cho a on shot. This result a historic moment for the Indonesian Under-23 team. This is the first time they have achieved a victory in Asia's premier Under-23 tournament. And this loss will be a big hit for Australia's ambitions of making the quarterfinals of the Under-23 Asian Cup and by extension the Paris 2024 Olympics. And we're going to go to the tennis court right now, where Iga Swiatek made a winning start to her Stuttgart title defense with a 6-3, 6-4 win against Elise Mertens of Belgium in the second round of the Porsche Tennis Grand Prix. The 2022 and 2023 champion was making her first appearance on the clay this season after a first round bye, and the world number one from Poland proved too strong for the Mertens. Winning an hour and 33 minutes, where Mertens made a Swiatek wait for the win, saving three match points. Swiatek will face Emma Raducanu in the quarterfinals. And definitely, this quarterfinal is going to be a lot of games to watch, starting with today, where earlier on Tuesday, Italy's Jasmine Paolini stunned Tunisian seventh seed Ons Jabeur with a 7-6, 10-8, 6-4 victory. Paolini will face fourth seed Elena Rybakina, next after the Kazakh claimed a hard fought. Their titles and their numbers were 7-6, 7-3, 1-6, 6-4 for the points. And of course, Wimbledon champion Markéta Vondrousova defeated Anastasia Potapova of Russia in the straight set last eight encounter with number two of Aryna Sabalenka. Meanwhile, Ukraine Marta Kostyuk will play American third seed Coco Gauff after saving five match points against China Sen Kinwen before going on to the beat Australian Open up to the score of 6-2, 2-4, and 7-5. So definitely this is going to be a quarterfinal at the Stuttgart Open to be watched. And we're going to our next update, where Casper Ruud booked a spot in the quarterfinals at the Barcelona Open on Thursday with a straight set victory over Jordan Thompson, 6-1, 6-4. Still from the court this time, where the third seed has now won more matches this year than any other player on the tour, with a tally of 26 matches, surpassing Jannik Sinner, who had 25. He will face Matteo Arnaldi in the next round on Friday. Now, before going to the Olympics, Joel Embiid has a lot of things to do right here on the NBA League, where he made 23 points and 15 rebounds and one huge assist to Kelly Oubre Jr. on a go-ahead three-point play that led the Sixers to a narrow 105-104 win over Miami Heat in the Eastern Conference play-in tournament Wednesday night. Embiid, as you've seen right now, exploded out of a quiet game late in the fourth and carried the Sixers back from the 14 down in the second half. Sixers earned the number 7 seed and advanced to play the second seed in New York Knicks in the opening round of the Eastern Conference playoffs. Game 1 is Saturday at Madison Square Garden, my favorite place, of course. And, of course, Heat, who went from the play-in tourney to the NBA Finals a year ago, hosts the winner of the night's late play-in game between Chicago and Atlanta on Friday night, with the winner getting the number 8 seed. Won't go. Fight for the rebound. Embiid comes out. Now, here from the Eastern Conference, Kobe White scored a career-high 42 points in the Chicago Bulls' advance in the play-in tournament, knocking out the Atlanta Hawks with a 131-116 victory on Wednesday. White had never scored more than 37 points in a regular season or postseason game, but in breakthrough season, he delivered his best performance to date. DeJounte Murray led Atlanta with 30 points, but the Hawks came up short again after dropping their final six regular season games. Nikola Vucevic had 24 points and 12 rebounds for Chicago, and DeMar DeRozan finished with 22 points and 9 assists. Atlanta's Trae Young and Clint Capela each scored 22, which Young, who missed 23 games late in the regular season because of a torn ligament in his left pinky, had 10 assists but committed 6 turnovers. Capela grabbed 17 rebounds. Bogdanovic added 21 points. So this is going to be a very interesting tournament to the final play-in tonight between the Chicago Bulls and Miami Heat, because as we know right now, the two main players of Miami Heat and also Chicago Bulls, they're now are injured. We have Chicago that is suffering a major win against the Hawks, but now they're losing their best defender, and that is Alex Caruso, that is now suffering apparent injury when he collided with teammate Andre Drummond in the early stages of the third quarter. Now, also with the Miami Heat, it seems that they're also missing out Jimmy Butler, as he suffered an MCL injury and is expected to sideline 4 weeks. And definitely, it is going to be a very pivotal game tonight, or it's going to be tomorrow morning right here in Indonesia. Definitely, they're going to reach for the spot in the playoffs. I'm going to keep you updated on that right here in our sports segment on the C Morning Show. To another sports update, it was the first twin-tip big air kite event of the Qatar Airways GKA Kite World Tour 2024, which took place in Le Barcarès, France. The sixth edition of the Lords of Tram hosted 24 men and 12 women in the opening round of the GKA Big Air Kite World Championship title race.
We'll be right back.
And we have many more updates from the world of sports later in the program. But right now, folks, it's time for us to take another short break. And after the break, Sara and Archie will be back with some entertainment updates. Stay tuned right here on The C-Money Show, only on See Today.
Kayaknya lucu juga nih kalau dapur kita kasih warna, nggak cuma warna coklat, warna putih, yang ternyata emang berhasil naikin mood rumah ini sih.
Untuk jendela, pintu, dan furniture-nya semuanya harus simple dan minimalis.
Kalau misalnya bolongannya dari utara, itu pasti lebih banyak angin yang masuk.
Ready to score a touchdown?
Oh, I'm born.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Go.
Gua yang penting apa yang gua makan bisa gua buang pada saat gua olahraga, segitu.
Jadi Abilal kalau ketemu mungkin dia ketawa gitu.
Dengan proses, gue bersyukur banget Kubu Junior tuh sempat bubar tahun 2016-2017.
Pilihnya sabu-sabu, karena sabu-sabu kita cuma makannya setahun sekali.
Kalau kita dengerin Spotify, Pak gimana sih caranya aku bisa masuk di sini gitu-gitu. Ya nggak boleh menghalangi lah.
The Indonesian state-owned enterprises ministry has underlined its commitment to supporting small and medium enterprises by launching vending machines at Soekarno-Hatta International Airport.
Qatar has advanced to the quarterfinals of the 2023 AFC Asian Cup after defeating Palestine 2-1 in the round of 16 at the Al Ayed Stadium in Al-Khor.
So we'll be back with the Danny Desert Entertainment.
See Indonesia, see the world, see today. Bye.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia!
Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Folks, welcome back to the C Morning Show, and right now we have entertainment updates just for you. And good news for all of you Swifties, as Taylor Swift dropped a library pop-up installation in Los Angeles to promote her upcoming album, The Tortured Poets Department, that will be released this Friday.
Yes, Taylor Swift has teamed up with Spotify for a special library installation pop-up at the Grove in Los Angeles this week, featuring carefully curated items regarding the Cruel Summer singer's new album. The installation consists of display of books that have hidden messages about Swift's upcoming songs, as well as some lyrics on the paper, a globe that pinned in Florida, and 72 drawers, which fans believe to be about her relationship with Joe Alwyn. This installation is open from April the 16th until 18th, from 10 a.m. until 9 p.m. every day.
Aside from dropping an installation, Swift also uploaded a short video on her Instagram account announcing the release date for her new album and her new music video. Her account also has a hidden feature where fans can see a countdown of her upcoming album release. Huh, I didn't know you can do that.
And Speaking about the album just waiting for it to drop away, a building, Chicago's River North, we are going to see how have a sports QR code and the words Taylor Swift, the Torture Post Department, painted on its side.
Interesting. So keeping with Taylor Swift's tradition of using cryptic messages and Easter eggs leading up to the album and music video releases, the mural has various letters which appears to be T, P, and D, and a number 13 display on it.
And the mural did not appear to be completed Tuesday afternoon, and scaffolding was blocking it partially. The QR code takes fans to a short on Swift's YouTube account, which reads Error 321.
Several were gathered near the building about noon Tuesday, trying to scan the code and decipher the message. The Tortured Poets Department will be released this Friday, certainly something Swifties around the world and here in Southeast Asia wouldn't want to miss.
Yes, and the social media has gone frenzy, especially how, you know, Taylor Swift has always been scared or insecure about her new albums or whatever she's working on to be leaked, and there was some alleged leaks on social media.
Oh, really?
Yes, but then again, the Swifties are waiting or anticipating for the new albums and, of course, the stories she has to tell and share with all her fans.
Are you a Swiftie yourself?
Well, of course. Well, nowadays, who isn't with the Swiftonomics going on, right?
That's a better question. Who is not a Swiftie? All right, folks, and moving on, we have other news from the world of K-pop, as K-pop fans now will want to mark August 10th on their calendar. Why? Because EXO Suho is coming for a solo concert. Check this out.
Yes, he will hold the show, dubbed Suho Concert, Su, home in Jakarta at the Tennis Indoor Senayan. However, no words yet from the promoter, Messi Mapro, on ticketing details and seating arrangements.
It will be part of a series of concerts which kicks off on July the 25th and 26th in Seoul. The shows will take place in the Philippines, Hong Kong, and Taipei, among others, as well. Promoter Messi Mapro has not yet provided information about tickets and seating arrangements at the venue.
Okay, we have given the Swifties and also the K-pop fans some information or news, but now for the Beatles fan. Are you a Beatles fan?
Now it's something that I'm really excited about.
There you go. Now, Archie, for the first time in over 50 years, a documentary film on the Beatles from 1970, Let It Be, will drop on May the 8th on Disney Plus.
Exciting.
So let's take a look.
The Beatles documentary film Let It Be, produced in 1970, is scheduled for release on May 8th. The documentary will be premiered after being restored for the first time in decades. The release announcement was made on the Beatles' social media accounts, confirming that Let It Be will be available for streaming on Disney Plus. Directed by Michael Lindsay-Hogg, the documentary chronicles the band's journey from rehearsals to recording sessions for their 12th and final studio album, Let It Be, in January 1969.
In a new motion picture. Let it be, let
it be, let it be. However, the film disappeared from official circulation since the 1980s and was only available through illegal bootleg copies. Let It Be was also previously considered for release on DVD and Blu-ray formats, but those plans never materialized. Eventually, Lord of the Rings director Peter Jackson gained access to restore the documentary, with the process carried out by Park Road Post-Production.
When we lost John, we knew that it was really over.
Let It Be is not the only Beatles work released decades after its creation. The band previously launched their final song titled Now and Then on November 2nd, 2023.
It's the last song that my dad and Paul and George and Ringo will get to make together.
How lucky was I to have those men in my life?
Wow, I'm very excited for this one, actually, because Let It Be is one of the Beatles' legendary... There's a lot of legendary documentary about the Beatles, but this one is like the top most, you know. And one other one is actually a really good one I really like is from Martin Scorsese. He made a documentary about George Harrison, one of the least, not say favorite, but least celebrated members of the Beatles, and it's titled George Harrison Living in the Material World. So that is, this one is actually one thing I'm excited about.
Yes, and you can watch it from the comfort of your own home and your time because it's streamed, right?
Yes.
So there you go. Something to watch during the days.
Yeah, you're right. And next up on the line, we have Indonesian group Kahitna now set to release a remake song titled Sejauh Dua Benua.
The group has announced their new project on their Instagram account at Kahitna. The song was previously written and sung by Archie Widianto and Brisia Jodi in October 2019.
Yes, the latest post showed Kahitna's bassist Dodi Isnaini wearing the same wardrobe costume in a video clip of Kahitna's Cantik that was shot in 1996. What makes it more special is that the video clip features one of Kahitna's vocalists who passed away in April 2023, Carlos Saba. The music video teaser shows Carlos smiling on television.
Many fans say that they have mixed feelings regarding the upcoming release of the remake song. And the song will be released today on April the 19th. So we can leave it to Kahitna to make all those romantic songs, Mas Yofi, with those romantic lyrics. But again, since this is a remake, fans have mixed feelings, but we'll find out today.
We'll find out today. We'll see that later on today.
Yes, and now we'll be taking another short break, but stay with us because after the break, we'll be back with the latest information from the world of business only on the C Morning Show.
Kayaknya lucu juga nih kalau dapur kita kasih warna, nggak cuma warna coklat, warna putih, yang ternyata emang berhasil naikin mood rumah ini sih.
Untuk jendela, pintu, dan furniture-nya semuanya harus simple dan minimalis.
Kalau misalnya bolongannya dari utara, itu pasti lebih banyak angin yang masuk.
Gue yang penting apa yang gue makan bisa gue buang pada saat gue olahraga gitu.
Jadi Abila kalau ketemu mungkin dia ketawa gitu.
Dengan proses gue bersyukur banget kubu junior tuh sempat bubar tahun 2016-2017.
Pilihnya sabu-sabu karena sabu-sabu kita cuma makannya setahun sekali.
Kalau kita dengerin Spotify, apa gimana sih caranya aku bisa masuk di sini gitu. Ya nggak boleh menghalangi lah.
The Indonesian State-owned Enterprises Ministry has underlined its commitment to supporting small and medium enterprises by launching vending machines at Soekarno-Hatta International Airport.
Qatar has advanced to the quarterfinals of the 2023 AFC Asian Cup after defeating Palestine 2-1 in the round of 16 at the Al Ayed Stadium in Al-Khor.
So we'll be back with the Danny Desert Entertainment.
See Indonesia, see the world, see you today.
Selamat malam pemirsa See You Today. Kita ketemu lagi di Ngonten ngobrolin tentang Nusantara.
Jadi gandrong gandring, Chris empu gandring.
Iya, itu dia.
Chris empu gandring. Ini kota apa ini?
Dari mana? Dari mana? Kira menurut kamu ini daerah mana? Dari daerah mana? Dari negara lain ini?
Malaysia.
Dari China?
Bukan.
India?
Asia Tenggara aja boleh gak? Namanya See You Today. See You Today Southeast Asian.
Binjai mau migrasi.
Cakep.
Anjay aku di potsi.
Ya aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik ya.
Aduh ya Allah. Kali ini.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia nggak sebaik itu, nggak sebagus itu, nggak seganteng itu. Tapi itu hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mas.
Pemain.
kenapa nama Thai PG ini berdiri? Kalau bahasa kayak kita tuh nama panggilannya tuh lebih gampang tuh panggil Aji tuh Thai PG. Thai PG itu kan panggil tuh Mak Gendut. Resepnya turun menurun. Nah, sedangkan saya baru ke generasi kedua.
Welcome back on the C Morning Show, and now it's time for business updates. And we begin with our first update, where staple Palawija crops saw a 23% rise increase in prices in Lingga Regency, Batam, Riau Island, a week after Eid al-Fitr holiday. And in Karawang, West Java, chicken boiler prices soared to 60,000 rupiah per kilogram, leading to a 60% drop in revenue. Several commodity prices have surged as ships from Jambi are not stopping in Dabo. Curly red chili prices rose from 52,000 to 65,000 rupiah per kilogram, while bird's eye chili prices are up from 80,000 rupiah to 85,000 rupiah per kilogram. The head of the trade division in the Department of Industry and Trade in Lingga Regency attributed the surge in prices to limited supplies from outside the city, such as Tanjung Pinang.
Alhamdulillah untuk kebutuhan harga-harga kebutuhan pokok itu relatif stabil, tapi ada beberapa komoditi khususnya yang disuplai dari wilayah Sumatera, Jambi dan sekitarnya, karena keterbatasan transportasi armada Roro itu kebetulan belum singgah ke tempat kita. Mereka terus dari Tungkal ke Batam, jadi supply khusus untuk cabai, jenis cabai dan sebagainya, sayuran yang berasal dari Jambi itu relatif kurang dan masuk dari wilayah Tanjung Pinang dan sekitarnya, dan mengalami peningkatan harga sedikit. Sekitar 20-23%. Tapi insya Allah, karena tingkat permintaan juga relatif turun.
Meanwhile, chicken prices also rose in Karawang, West Java. Chicken fillet has reached 60,000 rupiah per kilogram, while the usual chicken price was 48,000 rupiah per kilogram, making a 15% hike from normal prices. The public has been left complaining of higher prices as revenues were down by up to 60%. The city of Cilegon in Banten had seen more gold consumers during the Eid holidays, as many people were said to have swarmed jewelry stores to purchase and sell gold. Gold had set one record high after another over the past few months. However, interest in the commodity had soared even a week before Eid al-Fitr. The 375 gold is priced around 500,000 rupiah per gram, while 70 gold is sold at 800,000 rupiah per gram. Gold does not only make a good keepsake, but it is also considered a highly valued precious gift during holiday season.
Ini untuk harga emas sekarang lagi naik apa turun?
Lagi naik.
Naiknya berapa?
Udah satu bulan lebih mendadak naik. Sebenarnya naik itu udah dari setengah tahun yang lalu, dari bulan 10. Dari bulan 10 sih udah naik 300-an ya.
Ini yang paling tertinggi?
Hari ini paling tertinggi.
Oke.
Kalau emas 4, kadar 97, 1.140.
Kalau logam mulia?
1.200.000 lebih, tergantung besar gramannya, makin besar makin lebih murah.
Soalnya ini dapat THR anak-anak, mau dibeliin emas daripada buat beli yang lain.
Untuk investasi juga ya, Pak?
Iya, bukan investasi bodoh.
Itu harga emas sekarang berapa, Pak?
Kalau yang 24, 1.150.000.
MRT Jakarta signed a contract with the Japanese corporation Sojitz on Wednesday, April 17, 2024, to solidify its commitment to advancing railway construction for the second phase.
On On April 17, a Japanese corporation, Sojit, signed a contract with MRT Jakarta, marking a significant step forward in their partnership, ensuring the continuation of railway construction. The second phase aims to link the existing MRT station in Bundaran HI to the Kota area. Covering a distance of 5.8 kilometers, the second phase will traverse through six subway stations, including Harmoni, Sawah Besar, and Mangga Besar stations.
Tentu konsistensi ini didasarkan dengan hubungan baik antara Indonesia dan Jepang, tetapi juga keuletan daripada Pemda DKI di bawah Pak PJ Gubernur untuk melakukannya dengan konsisten.
MRT Jakarta faced challenges in finding contractors for this space due to several factors including pandemic-related disruptions and geopolitical tensions which impacted the supply chain.
And MRT is one of the number one project and a symbol of good cooperation Indonesia and Japan. We will continue. I promise to you to Japan will support 100% of the improvement of the life and the environment of Indonesian people.
Currently, progress of the second phase stands at 33.8% completion. The route to Monas is projected to start operating in 2027, while the route to Jakarta Kota will be operational by the end of 2029. Adelia Dinda and Nico Arianto for City Today.
Moving on to other news, Indonesian President Joko Widodo held a meeting with Apple CEO Tim Cook on Wednesday to discuss the possibility of expanding Apple's business in Indonesia and perhaps develop a facility. The meeting follows up on Apple's previous investment of around 1.6 trillion rupiah in Indonesia and the development of the Apple Academy in Tangerang, Surabaya, Batam, and Bali.
As part of his visit to Indonesia, Apple CEO Tim Cook held discussion with President Joko Widodo on Wednesday, exploring further cooperation and investment opportunities in the country. Among the topics discussed was the possibility of Apple opening a manufacturing facility in Indonesia.
We talked about the president's desire to see manufacturing in the country, and it's something that we will look at.
Indonesian Industry Minister Agung Gumiwang Kartasasmita said that in 2022, Indonesia imported around 2.8 million cellular phones, of which 85% were Apple products for $2 billion, making Indonesia a good market for Apple. That same year, Indonesia also manufactured 50 million cellular phones. Based on this data, Indonesia President Joko Widodo expressed hopes to Apple CEO that the company could expand in Indonesia by developing a manufacturing facility. Their manufacturing process is expected to use 35% locally produced components.
Jadi tadi kami sudah sepakat bahwa proses tersebut akan kita mulai. Proses untuk membangun manufaktur mereka di Indonesia atau mereka menggunakan komponen-komponen yang memang sudah bisa diproduksi di Indonesia. Nah, nanti setelah dari sini dari Kemenprint nanti akan melakukan proses business matching. Kami sudah punya listnya terhadap komponen-komponen apa saja, komponen-komponen HP, cell phones ya, yang sudah diproduksi di Indonesia yang mungkin bisa kita kawinkan, namanya business matching.
In the past 3 years, Apple has been looking to diversify its manufacturing facility outside from China after the COVID-19 pandemic shutdowns revealed the company's over-reliance on the country. Based on the company's 2022 data, Apple already has 28 manufacturing facilities in Vietnam and is seeking to invest more. Meanwhile, in Indonesia, Apple is set to build fourth Apple Developer Academy in Bali. Currently, there are three located in Surabaya, Batam, and Tangerang.
And that's all for the business updates for this episode of the C Morning Show. But stay with us because we'll be taking a break. And after the break, we'll be back with our first talk show where we'll be discussing more on how to overcome the holiday blues. So don't go anywhere and stay with us.
Well,
Welcome to City Day Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
City Day Business.
Figur publik kok kere. Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja.
Harus setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya bikin.
Bikin pesawat.
Bikin pesawat gitu.
Simsalabim.
Simsalabim.
Abrakadabra.
Abrakadabra.
Singgobang gosir.
Singgobang gosir.
Pala botak yang bisa disisir.
Pala botak yang bisa
absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia!
Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
The Indonesian state-owned enterprises ministry has underlined its commitment to supporting small and medium enterprises by launching vending machines at Soekarno-Hatta International Airport.
Qatar has advanced to the quarterfinals of the 2023 AFC Asian Cup after defeating Palestine 2-1 in the round of 16 at the Al Ayed Stadium in Al-Khor.
So we'll be back with the Danny Desert Entertainment.
See Indonesia, see the world, see today. Bye.
This is the situation at kilometer 414.
This morning experienced the crossing situation from Bakaheni, Lampung to Merak, Banten. And we didn't experience any traffic from Bakahuni until we arrived in Merak, Banten.
Jasa Marga predicts the peak of return flow on Eid al-Fitr celebration takes place on April 15, 2024.
Team Morning Show right here on See Today. It is the Friday edition and we're marking right now to the first discussion of the day. Well, the long Eid holiday season has officially come to an end. However, it's not uncommon that after the holiday passes, feelings of sadness and even loneliness start to creep in.
Wow, that's different.
I know, loneliness and sadness.
Yes.
Carol, we're Nicole Holingshed, a psychologist and clinical assistant professor of family and community medicine at the Ohio State University Wexner Medical Center, also says that after the holiday ends, people may feel lost or empty without engaging in activities that help them focus.
Indeed, this is what's known as post-holiday blues and referring to the short-term feelings experienced by someone after a holiday, including sadness, loneliness, fatigue, disappointment, lethargy, mental pressure, or even the fear of months ahead. So with that said, we're going to talk about this, Sarah.
Yes, Carol, we'll learn more about post-holiday blues, what exactly, because now we are joined in the studio by psychological associate and lecturer Regina Nafira. Good morning. Regina, how are you?
I'm fine, thank you.
Do you
so
have
much.
A post-holiday blues?
Not really.
No holidays for us.
I know holidays for us. But this is interesting, post-holiday blues, because we usually talk about, we joke around about coming back to work, but post-holiday blues, from a psychological perspective, what is actually holiday blues?
Actually, there is no clinical diagnosis of post-holiday blues. It's just, you know, it's just like a popular state, like from people opinion about this kind of thing. But it sometimes happens to everybody. On some people, it happens because they need some of adjustment. Mm-hmm. And also they have a lot of pressure from work, study, daily routine activity, like for stay-at-home mother, maybe stay-at-home father, something like that. And also if it stay with depression and anxiety sometimes, so it will be a problem.
Yeah.
And some people may experience such as, you know, irritability after that, because they really hard to adjust between holiday and vacation. They also like trapped in the feeling of nostalgic, like, oh, I want to stay in the holiday, but the problem is they work or maybe they daily activity.
I think I remember I have a post holiday blues is when I was in elementary or maybe in junior high school, right? Because high school I'm like, okay, I can't wait to see my friends. But elementary school and whenever we have holidays, we felt like, oh my god, we just only have 3 months of holidays or 1 month of holiday of summer. And then you just want to have more time, you know, being with your family, going around places. But when you're already a professional on the work zone, it seems it was kind of odd. Is this a mental health, like, disorder that you may say?
No, it's not a mental condition. And also, it's not mental disorder, but it can lead to be a mental condition when the depression or anxiety comes, like, more prominent, like, persists, like, more than 2 weeks. Yeah, more than 2 weeks, it might be more serious. Yeah. And it is some of professional hands. Mm-hmm. And that's the problem is, that's the thing is someone cannot find balance and coping strategy to, you know, to handle the stressors from daily routine, like off the holiday, they want to go back there. Yeah, that's the thing, it's not a
mental condition. Definitely people on Monday or next Monday, they will have this post-holiday blues, but probably Tuesday they already adapt to it. Like, okay, I'm back in the zone. Okay, it's time to go to work again.
Time to go back to work.
Yeah.
But speaking of people who are more prone to the holiday blues, you have mentioned before, Regina, that some people may feel these post-holiday blues. Are there some people who you think are more at risk? For example, a certain age group, or, for example, what kind of work they are doing, or probably because for people who are working and also living separate from their families, who are more at risk?
Okay, it's actually, we need to see this deeply, each case by case. Mm-hmm. Like, each person has different, like, their immunity of personality, so that's the thing. So the problem is the way they try to enjoy their life, being mindful, being aware that the present is important. Like, they only waiting for, okay, we need to weekend and then break or something. Yeah. They don't enjoy their life, so the problem is that.
Yeah.
And the symptoms, when should we be more aware, or when should we seek professional help? Because as Carol mentioned before, we often feel this as well. I mean, going back to school back then and then going back to work sometimes, okay, but sometimes we can get over it personally. Yeah. But when should we seek professional help?
Okay, when we are returning home long after the holiday, after 2 weeks, and then we feel the negative thing in ourselves and, you know, it affects negatively in our daily life and our relationship with others, we can get connect even to ourselves and people and our work, our performance, and we are lack of motivation. So it's time to go to the professional because they will help us to, you know, recognize the symptoms and also make a diagnosis. And some people can get the best treatment of it when they cannot like cope with this.
Definitely, Regina, there are some signs, right? Symptoms and also the signs that when one felt like, okay, I'm getting more depressed. Loneliness, when you were saying that one of the symptoms are loneliness, because probably someone that is working that very far, maybe they're living abroad or, you know, in different areas with the family or with the loved ones, they would feel like so lonely because after that 1 week or 10 days period they're together, now I have to be apart again from my family or my loved ones. So what kind of the signs, or how can you step back to reality when you felt like, okay, this is, I'm getting more depressed, this is getting more severe, how should we go back to reality?
Yeah, it's like homesick, kind of like that. I was also in that position, like everybody, homesick. But the most important thing is self-care. Do self-care. Do some space for yourself. It's okay for being alone. Loneliness, it's okay. Sometimes it's bad, but being alone, it's not that bad.
That's right.
Yeah, you can get connect with yourself. Just thinking that what you are doing is valuable. This is important. Why you have to do this? It's worthy to stay away from your family like for a while maybe, and you can go back with smile, but no, you have to leave now. And sometimes we need to understand that we have to be grateful for what we have right now, for being present.
I love that word, grateful. Sometimes we're just not grateful enough to what we have right now. Because sometimes we see, you know, what is above from others, but we don't see what we have, right?
Yeah, exactly.
And then I also love about being alone does not always mean that you're lonely as well.
Yes, definitely. Right?
So it's something you have to be able to focus on as well. And speaking of post-holiday blues and how to overcome it, can you please also share with us, is this a one-time trigger or one-time thing after the holidays? Yes, you can face post-holiday blues. Or is it like an accumulation of what has been gone through by a certain individual throughout its time of work?
Like we help someone, something like that.
Yes, because we may work for like a certain amount of time, let's say 6 months, and then we take a holiday. Is it because only the holiday itself, because we feel the loved ones at home and then we have to go back to work? Or is it because stress we find at work, but we just blame it on the holiday?
It's like a domino effect.
Oh, yeah. Okay, the problem is we need to recognize first the stressor that come to us. What kind of stressor? Okay, we have to understand this. Stop blaming something because the problem is in ourselves sometimes. And of course, of course we also have the environment. We cannot like, you know, avoid the feelings that we miss someone or we love someone and then we have to stay away or something like that. But the most important thing that we need to understand this first, the stressor. And because when we try to understand and recognize the stressor or any symptom that we feel, we can handle it effectively. Because sometimes some people, they don't have, you know, the ability to recognize the stressor. And then they just try to go to, you know, a bad lifestyle, like eating something like too sweet or drinking alcohol. When you're stressed, it's not that good to do kind of thing. Because the most important thing is like, find a good way to make you feeling natural first. Just do not think that, okay, I want to be happy. It doesn't mean that when you are sad, you can be happy like instantly. No, it's the process. And we need to find that process. And of course, it's okay to talk to someone else that you trust.
Yeah.
To, you know, like give the feeling and then make the memories like permanent. It doesn't mean that's bad to remember the memory and then understand this, but awareness and mindfulness is important.
Yeah, and very mindful of how we live, right? And again, you were saying before that I love that word, being grateful. Have pride in yourself that what you're doing right now, you're going back to work, you have a job. It is very hard right now to find jobs. And if you have one, you know, you should be grateful and very mindful that you have one and you're so blessed with that. And then you're working hard for maybe another month or another time that you're gonna have a holiday, be back again with your family members or having a holiday for yourself. And it's just a reflection of yourself knowing that, yes, I am capable of doing what I can right now and I'm very grateful for what I have. And then finding activities, I said, like you said, you know, eating sweets, food intake is really matters, right? And then for like for me, for instance, I love working out. Like working out takes out the endorphins. I feel just better after 1 hour after I work out. So find the activities that you love to do to love yourself back. And then you can love others too. So once that, Regina, we love ourselves, we're very content, but we see our friends or our family members are maybe experiencing the post-holiday blues.
Yeah.
How should we, you know, give care to them and how should we motivate them?
Okay, when we are talking about our family member or friends that, you know, experience post-holiday blues, the most important thing is we try to be a good listener. Okay, that's the best to give them positive feedback. Just validate their feelings. We can help them to feel like, okay, you are valuable. Just do your activity now, like live in your present, live your life now, something like that. But sometimes, you know, the spillover after holiday, it will be a problem. It like, you know, comes the problem and situation. And we have to understand and recognize sometimes when it comes and we can see the tendency of, you know, kind of, clinical depression, we can see this when it gets worse from them. So it means that we can give them advice, just go to professional because you cannot handle this. You will expend your energy and you will get, you know, drained, emotionally drained when you are not capable enough to handle this kind of clinical condition. But if it's still normal, it's okay, just help them to go to relax and just talk much and just probing them to just talk, come on, we can go relax and something like that and help them.
And what is the worst case scenario if one does not seek professional help when they need to?
Okay, it means that they find the imbalance, right? Physically, psychologically, and you know, mentally. The problem is they cannot live well. Like, they are incapable to do good thing, they cannot, you know, they will be lack of motivation. Can you imagine they cannot finish their job, their work? They said they being so lazy, lack of motivation, and they can be run away from the thing, they being unresponsible mm-hmm. from the thing that they have to do. Mm-hmm. That's the thing.
And do you agree, as a psychologist, from a psychological perspective, that for a vacation that takes too much of your time, you have taken a vacation for way too long, is prone to more post-holiday blues?
If like we take the vacation too long.
Yes, for say weeks, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, or it doesn't matter, as long as the psychological
condition. I would love to have 3 weeks holiday.
I already got
going back to school.
That's right. it doesn't matter actually about the time, like how many days that you spend for holidays. But the most important, just give some preventive way to have like 2 or 3 days before we go for daily work or daily life routine. Take 3 days to adjust. We still have the self-care and get connection and, you know, time for adjust.
Okay,
this is
back.
Your holiday, just stay at home for 3 days and then you go for work. It will be better and help someone.
Yeah, definitely. I think, you know, coming back to real life right now, because this is where we live, where we do our activities and whatnot, knowing that in the later days, we're going to have our holiday again, where you can have your relaxation and more time with your family and loved ones. Regina, thank you very much for your time and you know giving us the insights for us not to have a post-holiday blues, definitely. But we should talk more about the baby blues for the since we're mothers right here. Okay. Regina, thank you so much for your time. We'll see
you're
you again.
Welcome.
All right, folks, so we are going to step back momentarily, but when we return, we will have the world headlines. Don't go anywhere. Stay tuned right here on the C-Morning Show, only on C Today. We'll be right back.
Kayaknya lucu juga nih kalau dapur kita kasih warna, nggak cuma warna coklat, warna putih, yang ternyata emang berhasil naikin mood rumah ini sih.
Untuk jendela, pintu, dan furniture-nya semuanya harus simple dan minimalis.
Kalau misalnya bolongannya dari utara, itu pasti lebih banyak angin yang masuk.
Ready to score a touchdown?
Oh, I was born ready.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Go.
Gue yang penting apa yang gue makan bisa gue buang pada saat gue olahraga, segitu.
Jadi Ardila kalau ketemu mungkin dia ketawa. Gitu.
Dengan proses, gue bersyukur banget Kubu Junior tuh sempat bubar tahun 2016-2017.
Pilihnya sabu-sabu, karena sabu-sabu kita cuma makannya setahun sekali.
Kalau kita dengerin Spotify, ya, Pak gimana sih caranya aku bisa masuk di sini ke sedikit? Ya nggak boleh menghalangi lah.
The Indonesian state-owned enterprises ministry has underlined its commitment to supporting small and medium enterprises by launching vending machines at Soekarno-Hatta International Airport.
Qatar has advanced to the quarterfinals of the 2023 AFC Asian Cup after defeating Palestine 2-1 in the round of 16 at the Al Ayed Stadium in Al Khor.
So we'll be back with the Danny Desert Entertainment.
See Indonesia, see the world, see today.
Bye.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia!
Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Oh, yeah.
Selamat malam pemirsa See You Today. Kita ketemu lagi di Ngonten, ngobrolin tentang Nusantara.
Dari Gandrong Gandring, Chris Empu Gandring.
Iya, itu dia.
Chris Empu Gandring. Amin ya. Ini apa ini?
Dari mana? Kira menurut kamu ini daerah mana? Dari daerah mana? Dari negara lain ini?
Malaysia.
Dari China?
Bukan.
India?
Bukan. Asia Tenggara aja boleh gak? Namanya See You Today. See You Today itu Southeast Asian.
Ke Binjai mau migrasi.
Cakep.
Anjay, aku deport sih.
Ya, aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik ya.
Aduh ya Allah.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia gak sebaik itu, gak sebagus itu, gak seganteng itu. Tapi tuh hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mars.
Pemain.
This is the situation at kilometer 414.
This morning experienced the crossing situation from Bakaheni Lampung to Merak Banten and we didn't experience any traffic from Bakahuni until we arrive in Merak Banten.
Jasa Marga predicts the peak of return flow on Eid al-Fitr celebration takes place on April 15, 2024.
Figur publik kok kere.
Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Gitu. Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Harus setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya gitu, bikin.
Bikin pesawat
gitu.
Sim salabim.
Abrakadabra.
Singgobang gosir.
Pala botak gak bisa disisir.
Pala botak gak bisa.
Hello, folks. Welcome back to the See Morning Show right here on See. Today, we have our world updates in this segment, and we have also a couple of updates in regards to the conflicts around the world. We begin with the first, where the city of Chernihiv in northern Ukraine was hit by Russian missiles on Wednesday morning. The attack had destroyed an apartment building and left many casualties.
Three Russian missiles slammed into a downtown area of the northern Ukrainian city of Chernihiv on Wednesday, hitting an 8th-floor apartment building and killing 17. According to Ukrainian emergency services, at least 60, including 3 children, were wounded in the morning attack.
Як бачите, що пошукові роботи тривають, можуть бути люди. В тих місцях, де ми позначили одну людину, одне тіло вже дістали. Надалі ще тривають пошукові роботи, там де позначені інші місця.
Ukrainian ambassador to Indonesia Fasil Hamianin in Jakarta asked Indonesian people support condemn the attack.
Yesterday the city of Chernihiv was attacked and the casualties now amount to 17 or more killed directly and over 60 badly wounded, and the number is increasing because while our rescuers are digging the debris and trying to save the people from the destroyed houses. Once again, I express my hope that the people of Indonesia, Rakyat Indonesia, will condemn the actions.
Chernihiv lies about 150 kilometers over 90 miles north of the capital Kyiv, near the border with Russia and Belarus. Chernihiv has a population of around 250,000. The latest Russian bombardment came as the war stretched into its third year and approach what could be a critical juncture, as a lack of further military support from Ukraine's Western partners increasingly leaves it at the mercy of the Kremlin's bigger forces.
And now moving on, we now have information regarding the updates in Gaza, where scaling up assistance in Gaza remains a challenge in the face of continued access denials, delays, and also other impediments. According to United Nations news, between the 6th until the 12th of April, 41% of humanitarian requests to the north were denied.
A UN convoy also came under crossfire while near a checkpoint during the same period. Following is the story of how food has been so scarce in the Gaza Strip.
Scores of Gazans stood in line to get boxes of aid in the central city of Deir al-Balah in the Gaza Strip on Thursday. They need to wait in days after they registered their names to get food months ago.
أنا والله جاية فجأة سجلت بالمدرسة من قيمة شهرين جاية فجأة بطلع على الأسماء لقيت اسمي موجود يعني أنا فرحت لما لقيت اسمي موجود أخذت الكرتون.
Large numbers of food parcels were handed over to displaced Palestinians who queued up outside UNRWA school that now houses the offices of charity.
بالنسبة لأن أنا أقدر أوفر قوت يومي صعب جدا بالنسبة لأسعار أسعار غالية أنت تروح تشتري سعر غالي يعني فوق الخيال يعني مش نسبة مثلا قول 2% غلا 10% قول 300% شو هذا مش قادرين نشتري عندنا حاجة.
Each the area because of the fighting forcing many displaced Palestinians to the south of Gaza.
ما عندناش دخل ثابت، ما فيش من اولادي ولا واحد متوظف ولا جوزي متوظف. كلهم عمال. وبما ان هلقيت احنا هنا في الجنوب ما فيش دخل مادي. يعني بنوفر حاجات يعني بسيطة للأطفال، يعني بخس عليهم بمرقوا عن العصير، بدنا عصير يا ستي، بدنا عصير يا ماما، بدنا بسكوتات، بدنا لو طلع كابونه وفيها شويه حلاوه فيها شويه عصير بيطيروا من الفرحه عليها لانهم محرومين وهذا طبعا احنا مش قادرين نوفر لهم.
Food has been scarce in the strip since Israel's offensive that has caused widespread devastation and killed over 33,800 people.
And in regards with the distribution aid, now the United Nations Agency for Palestine Refugees, UNRWA, says humanitarian agency faced continuous challenges in delivering the aid to the people, especially to the north. And they had posted on the X, and I will just mention a couple of factors right here. Time is an aid crossing into Gaza is subject to complex. The requirements during the offload, cold chain, sensitive cold chain cargo, food and medicine is offloaded and let exposed until the UN is allowed to pick it up. Safety of the UN teams. Aid convoys have been hit multiple times by drones and also by missiles. Space, UNRWA's main logistic base in Rafah is only partially operational. Warehouse and distribution space is limited throughout the enclave and most of it's no longer possible to reach or has been destroyed. Trucks, since the beginning of Israel war on Gaza, most of the agency's trucks used to transport aid have been damaged or destroyed. And also clearance right now by the Israel military. I mean, there's a lot of trucks that is right now in line in the borders just to have that clearance by the Israel military to come in. In regards to this, though, although there are 9 countries thus far that tried to find other alternatives, and that is disperse the aid by airdrops, first by the Jordanian Armed Forces led the mission to deliver hundreds of tons of resources to the war-torn enclave. UAE, UK, US, there's France, Germany, the Netherlands, Egypt, and also Indonesia. I mean, this is a, even though this is a great way to penetrate the aid to the ground, but it's not 100% success because we've heard and also we reported there's many casualties where the aid just dropped onto the people, yes. Injured, some victims even dead. And there are some aids that is just dropped not on the target, so it's right there on the sea and it's just washed away. So this is definitely one of the ways that they can do it right now, but on ground, disbursement of aid is the only way to go.
Right. And it is actually a heartwarming to see all these countries working together to give one of humanity's basic need, which is food and also yes. clean water. What is really saddening is when somebody or someone is trying to stop them from doing it.
Yeah, an analysis and also a lot of experts are saying, and there's a data that they had made a research by May, if this is still ongoing, especially the Palestinian in the north, they are going to face famine 100%. So May is coming within a couple of days right now.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah, so hopefully the aids will get into the people of Palestine soon enough. And moving on, folks, 2 jurors in former President Donald Trump's hush money trial were dismissed on Thursday, one after expressing doubt about her ability to be fair and impartial, and the other over concerns that some of his answer in court may not have been accurate.
The dismissals reduced to 5 the number of jurors who have been seated for the first ever criminal trial of a former president. The setbacks in the selection process emerged during a frenetic morning in which prosecutors also asked for Trump to be held in contempt over a series of social media posts this week. The judge in the case barred reporters from identifying jurors' employers after expressing privacy concerns.
It has been a tumultuous third day of jury selection in Donald Trump's hush money criminal trial. The day began with seven seated jurors, but now there are just five. Two jurors were dismissed after being seated and sworn in. The first, a nurse from Manhattan who said that she feared she could not be impartial or fair, could not keep the outside influences out of her judgment of the case after people started reaching out and asking if she was on the jury. She was concerned about identifying information about her making its way to the media and being able to identify her. Jurors in this case are anonymous for the most part. The parties have the names, Donald Trump has the names, but the rest of the world does not know who these people are. Then, later in the day, a second juror was dismissed. This man, an IT professional, had said during questioning that he found Donald Trump mysterious and fascinating, but prosecutors raised questions about whether he had honestly answered a question about having in the past been accused or convicted of a crime. Prosecutors said they found a news article about a man with the same name who had been arrested in the 1990s for tearing down political posters in the New York City suburbs. After a conference in court where the man was brought back to the courthouse to answer questions, he was dismissed from the jury as well. Adding to that, more drama in the courtroom. Prosecutors are again seeking to hold Donald Trump in contempt of court. They have cited seven social media posts that he has made since the court began on Monday that they want to add to a hearing next week where they seek to have Donald Trump fined at least $3,000 and possibly face additional sanctions. Also, the judge, in light of what has happened to these two jurors and identifying information possibly getting out into the public, he has ordered the media to stop reporting the specific names of potential jurors' employers and previous employers. And since he made that order, people who have been interviewed for the jury pool in the jury box, potential jurors, they have been talking about their employment in more generic terms, working in finance, in banking, as a lawyer, but not identifying which law firm or which bank.
Now, we do have news still from the United States, but this time with a royal. Prince Harry, the son of King Charles III and fifth in line to the British throne, has formally confirmed now he is a U.S. resident.
And the filing further separates Harry from his role as one of the king's counselors of state, members of the royal family who can be deputized to carry out the duties of the monarch if he is unwell or out of the country.
Yes, although Harry and Meghan have put down roots in the wealthy enclave of Montecito, where they are raising their young son and daughter, Harry is also facing scrutiny about his U.S. residency.
It's getting spicy right here. 4 years after Harry and his American wife, Meghan Markle, the Duchess of Sussex, decamped to a villa in Southern California, a travel company he controls filed paperwork this week, informing British authorities that he has moved and is now usually resided in the United States. The paperwork was filed by Travelist LTD, a company at least 75% owned by Harry and which was founded in 2020 to promote global awareness of the importance of sustainable tourism.
The documentation was received Monday by the company's house, the government agency that oversees the incorporation of UK companies. While Harry formally remains a counselor of state, the Crown informed Parliament in 2022 that in practice, only working members of the royal family would be called upon to fill in for the monarch.
The Heritage Foundation, a conservative think tank, has questioned the Department of Homeland Security's decision to grant Harry a U.S. visa following admissions of drug use that were included in SPARE. The foundation, which has asked a judge to force the department to release Harry's immigration file, argues that the prince either lied on his visa application or was given special treatment because a story of a drug use would normally disqualify an applicant from being granted a visa.
Now let's just talk about the Royals just a little bit. I mean, this is another spectrum right here. So I already asked Archie, do you follow the Royals? He said, oh, when the news just pop up. But I know I have a fellow sister who's a Royalist right here. So what do you think? I mean, it seems that when Meghan and also Harry first, they made the announcement they're going to move to the United States. Yes. They're going to reside there. We felt, I mean, it seems that the British felt like, okay, it's time for you to go. I think we're happy with William and also with Catherine here. But now we're also seeing a lot of dynamics in the royal family.
And then this is also for the public to see how many have judged Harry for him, let's say, turning back on his family and moving to the States with his wife at that time. But now seeing what's going on with William and Catherine and how the British press is handling everything that's going on with the royal family, the public that was once judging Harry for his decision is now probably getting that realization, probably Harry was actually doing this the best for his family for his children at that time.
Even though he made out a book, Spare, and Netflix, he's putting out on open on everything what is happening
with those
family
interviews
and whatnot. But now we're seeing that the Montecito family are much more in a more peaceful way. And we know also Meghan Markle, the Duchess of Sussex, she made out a new product. Did you know about this? It's a jam. So the jam is called American Riviera Orchard Montecito Goodness. Wow. And she sent out to her friends, 50 friends, and on the jar it stated 17 out of 50.
Oh!
So, Sarah, would you want to have some jam?
Oh, I love that. I bet you would love too.
Jam and crumpets, why not? All right, now we're going to shift our focus back to the Middle East right now, where the United Arab Emirates had tried to wring itself out Thursday after the heaviest recorded rainfall ever to hit the desert nation, with its main airport allowing more flights.
The flooding sparked speculation that the UAE's aggressive campaign of cloud seeding, flying small planes through clouds dispersing chemicals aimed at getting rain to fall, may have contributed to the deluge.
However, experts say that the storm systems that produced the rain were forecasted well in advance and that cloud seeding alone would not have caused such flooding.
Not only rescuing people, police officers in Dubai rescued a cat during an unprecedented rainstorm that hit the United Arab Emirates. The black and white cat was seen clinging to the handle of a car in flood water on Wednesday. By the end of Tuesday, more than 142 millimeters or 5.5 inches of rainfall had soaked Dubai over 24 hours. The UAE's drainage systems quickly became overwhelmed, flooded out neighborhoods, business districts, and even portions of the 12-lane Sheikh Zayed Road highway running through Dubai. Dubai International Airport, the world's busiest for international travel, has allowed global carriers to again fly into Terminal 1 at the airfield. However, Dubai Airport CEO Paul Griffiths said that the airfield needed at least another 24 hours to resume operations close to its usual schedule. The airport ended up needing 22 tankers with vacuum pumps to get water off its grounds.
The real issues, I think, started on Tuesday when the storm cells came across from Saudi Arabia, and we were looking at the radar thinking, goodness, if this hits, then it's going to be cataclysmic. And indeed it was.
Long-haul carrier Emirates, crucial to east-west travel, has begun allowing local passengers to arrive at Terminal 3, their base of operations.
When, of course, the check-in moratorium expired, that's when everyone came to the airport in an attempt to get on flights. So I think we had more than 2,000 people in T3 getting to rebook their flights and getting checked in and away. I was there about 12 p.m. today, and it was extremely busy, but I think the customers were, you know, good-humoured. They accept the situation. They realise that we can't control the weather.
Emirates, whose operations had been struggling since the storm Tuesday, had stopped travellers flying out of the UAE from checking into their flights as they tried to move out connecting passengers. Pilots and flight crews also had a hard time reaching the airport given the water on the roadways. On Thursday, Emirates lifted that order to allow customers into the airport. That saw some 2,000 people come into Terminal 3, again sparking long lines. Some travelers who arrived in Dubai describe hours-long waits to get their baggage, with some just giving up to head home or to whatever hotel would have them.
And it's great to see that everything is more subdued right now and everything is going back to normal in the United Arab Emirates. And right now we're going to take a short break, but when we return, we're going to shift our focus to the Southeast Asia region. Stay tuned.
Kayaknya lucu juga nih kalau dapur kita kasih warna, nggak cuma warna coklat, warna putih, yang ternyata emang berhasil naikin mood rumah ini sih.
Untuk jendela, pintu, dan furniturnya semuanya harus simple dan minimalis.
Kalau misalnya bolongannya dari utara, itu pasti lebih banyak angin yang masuk.
Ready to score a touchdown?
Oh, I was born ready.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Go.
The Indonesian State-owned Enterprises Ministry has underlined its commitment to supporting small and medium enterprises by launching vending machines at Soekarno-Hatta International Airport.
Qatar has advanced to the quarterfinals of the 2023 AFC Asian Cup after defeating Palestine 2-1 in the round of 16 at the Al Ayed Stadium in Al-Khor.
So we'll be back with the Daily Desert Entertainment.
See Indonesia, see the world, see today.
Selamat malam pemirsa See You Today. Kita ketemu lagi di Ngonten, ngobrolin tentang Nusantara.
Dari gandrong gandring, Chris empuk gandring.
Iya, itu dia.
Chris empuk gandring. Amin. Happy apa ini?
Dari mana? Dari mana? Kira menurut kamu ini dari mana? Dari daerah mana? Dari negara lain ini?
Malaysia.
Dari China?
Bukan.
India?
Bukan. Asia Tenggara aja boleh gak? Namanya See You Today. See You Today Southeast Asian.
Ke Binjai mau migrasi.
Cakep.
Anjay aku deport sih.
Ya aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik loh.
Aduh ya Allah. Kali ini.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia nggak sebaik itu, nggak sebagus itu, nggak seganteng itu, tapi tuh hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mars.
Pemain.
This is the situation at kilometer 414.
This morning experienced the crossing situation from Bakaheni, Lampung to Merak, Banten. And we didn't experience any traffic from Bakahuni until we arrived in Merak, Banten.
Jasa Marga predicts the peak of return flow on Eid al-Fitr celebration takes place on April 15, 2024.
Back again right here with me, Archie, and also Sarah on the Sea Morning Show. And of course, as mentioned before, we are going to see some updates from the region of Southeast Asia, and we begin with the headlines. The annual joint military exercise Balikatan is set to be held by the Philippines and the United States. For the first time, it will be held beyond the Philippine territorial waters, which extends about 22 kilometers from its coastline. The exercises will be focused on the northern and western parts of the Philippines, which is near the potential flash points of the South China Sea and Taiwan.
During the state visit to Thailand on Wednesday, April 17, New Zealand Prime Minister Christopher Luxon and his Thai counterpart Sreta Thavisit agreed to establish stronger relations. Bilateral ties are set to be elevated into a strategic partnership in 2026 to mark 70 years of New Zealand-Thailand relations.
On Thursday, Vietnam clinched a 3-1 win over Kuwait in the U23 Asian Cup. The Golden Star Warriors now led the group, having scored one more goal than Uzbekistan, who won their first game 2-0 against Malaysia. They will face each other on Saturday, and a win would bring them closer to the quarterfinals. Now, Malaysia Airlines and AirAsia have cancelled flights to Sabah and Sarawak following the eruption of Mount Ruang in North Sulawesi, Indonesia. Malaysia Airlines cancelled 19 flights on Thursday and AirAsia 16.
The former later announced on X that it is working to accommodate passengers affected by flight cancellations with alternative flights once the situation improves. Meanwhile, AirAsia says that it is allowing passengers to make a one-time change to a new travel date within 30 days of the original departure date on the same route at no additional cost, subject to seat availability.
Mount Ruang has been active in spewing lava and ash clouds and erupted several times on Tuesday and also on Wednesday. Indonesian authorities had raised the alert level for the 725-meter volcano to the highest point on Wednesday night.
Yes, that's right, Carol. And we have a bit of a fact about Mount Ruang that spewed lava a few days ago. It is surrounded by two villages around the mountain with 838 lives. And among that, also, it is located in the Sitaro Islands Regency of North Sulawesi. And according to the government statement, 11,615 civilians will be evacuated to Manado following the eruption of Mount Ruang. And this may be caused by multiple subductions in Doi Island, North Moluccas, or in other words, earthquakes, according to Heru Ningtyas, head of the PVMBG.
Yeah, and we've seen already a couple of pictures that what happened in the eruption at night. And also with the thunders, that is something that is very uncommon. Never seen that before. It looks very beautiful, but we know that right now we're on alert.
Yes, the natural forces, and especially how the government has also taken mitigation steps, especially to help evacuate the local residents there with the potential tsunami, is also underway. So we hope and pray the best for Mount Ruang and the areas surrounding it.
Definitely. Yeah.
And now we move on to other news. On Wednesday, Myanmar's military government have released thousands of prisoners to coincide with the Thingyan.
Thingyan is a Buddhist festival celebrated in Myanmar every New Year based on the Burmese calendar, which usually occurs in the middle of April.
Over 3,300 Myanmar nationals and 36 foreigners were released. The number was slightly more compared to last year. The foreigners include 13 Indonesians and 15 Sri Lankans.
This release was aimed at generating public goodwill, improving diplomatic relations, and meeting humanitarian needs.
The release came with a condition that required prisoners to be on their best behavior or be sent to prison again to serve their unexpired terms.
Moving on to the next news, as Brunei and United Kingdom have launched a Green Economy Framework report to guide long-term economic growth and environmental preservation in the former.
On Wednesday, Solange, Brunei's Finance and Economic Affairs Minister Amin Liu Abdullah emphasized the need to move away from fossil fuels as a key driver of Brunei's economy. For his part, British High Commissioner to Brunei, John Virgo, highlighted the challenge both countries had faced in developing new economic models that generate prosperity and jobs in a more sustainable way.
The report of the United Kingdom-Brunei Strategic Dialogue provides an overview of climate change's impact on Brunei's economy. It identifies opportunities and challenges to develop a green economy that contributes to production, job creation, and reducing carbon emissions. Additionally, the report promotes collaboration to identify investment opportunities, improve policies, facilitate business, and establish international partnerships for a resilient and sustainable economy in Brunei. It aims to balance environmental stewardship with economic prosperity. And now we are up for another break. And in the meantime, please do stay connected with us at C2Day News on Instagram, X, and also YouTube. Don't go anywhere. Stay with us on the City Morning Show.
Welcome to City Day Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
City Day Business.
Figur publik kok kere. Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja.
Harus setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya bikin.
Bikin pesawat.
Bikin pesawat gitu.
Simsalabim.
Simsalabim.
Abrakadabra.
Abrakadabra.
Singgobang gosir.
Singgobang gosir.
Pala botak gak bisa disisir.
Pala botak gak bisa
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga. Indonesia!
Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
The Indonesian State-Owned Enterprises Ministry has underlined its commitment to supporting small and medium enterprises by launching vending machines at Soekarno-Hatta International Airport.
Qatar has advanced to the quarterfinals of the 2023 AFC Asian Cup after defeating Palestine 2-1 in the round of 16 at the Al Ayed Stadium in Al-Khor.
So we'll be back with the Danny Desert Entertainment.
See Indonesia, see the world, see today.
Kenapa nama TPG ini berdiri? Kalau bahasa kayak kita tuh nama panggilannya tuh lebih gampang tuh panggil Aji tuh TPG. TPG itu kan panggil tuh Mak Gendut. Resepnya turun menurun. Nah, sedangkan saya baru ke generasi kedua.
Back to the program, we're here, and right now we're going to jump into our second discussion of the day, which is very interesting, and also we need to pay a matter and of the emergence of this topic, where approximately 15 years ago electronic cigarettes had started making the waves coming here to Indonesia. Over time, this form of smoking gained popularity and allure even among teenagers.
Yes, in fact, some people believe that electronic cigarettes are safer and quote healthier than traditional ones. However, there have been several severe cases in the community due to consistent use of electronic cigarettes.
The first story comes from a content creator, Permesta Diaz, who suffered from lung inflammation. Her social media account revealed that she required specialized treatment due to the recurrent coughing spells induced by inhaling vapor from electronic cigarettes. The amalgamation of electronic cigarettes and vape has undeniably permeated the realm of young smokers, yet the ramifications are perilous.
Another story comes from Rico Thomas Dwi Ardana, a young man from Klaten, Central Java, found himself grappling with pharyngitis as a result of 7 years of relentless vaping and smoking conventional cigarettes. On his personal TikTok account, Ardana shared his story battling against a respiratory disease that caused him hospitalized 4 times in a year. And now, folks, to discuss more about the danger of electronic cigarettes, we have Professor Dr. Erlina Burhan here with us at the studio. So, good morning, Doctor.
Good morning.
Thank you for being
Thank
here
you
with
so
us.
Much.
My pleasure.
Yes. So, Prof, we want to ask to you about the danger of electronic cigarettes, which are, of course, very prevalent in mm-hmm. us in the community right now. And according to a data gathered by the Global Youth Tobacco Survey, the use of electronic cigarettes has increased rapidly, up to 10 times in the last year. So, what do you think are the reasons behind this?
Yes, there are some reasons for this rapid increasing of the use of electronic cigarette. Mm-hmm. First is the misconception, and also misleading.
Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. The people think that this e-cigarette, electronic cigarette, or vape, are safer
yeah.
than a traditional tobacco cigarette, which is not correct.
Mm-hmm.
And they keep believing in that.
Yeah.
And then the misconception also of the ingredients and the impact of the e-cigarette. Mm. So that is one thing. The second is that the electronic cigarette have this flavor. Yeah.
Yes.
So you know the young people, mm. they like to have experimenting of this taste and yeah. sensation.
That's right.
They feel it's a very cool.
Right, Professor.
Yeah, very cool, superb, and also the marketing, a strategic marketing also I think play an important role of leading the opinion of people that normalizing and glamorizing of using of electronic cigarette, which is very sad.
Glamorizing, yeah. that is
glamorizing.
One term.
Yeah. Yes. Feel like high level.
That's right, yeah. right.
Yes. And then also the other thing is the social media.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you can see from the social media that the youngster now very proudly posting that they use electronic cigarette, yes. vaping, and you know maybe also the peer group pressure
yeah.
that want to be accepted in the. Yeah.
Amongst their groups.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So that is one thing. And also a lot of influencer also play the role of introducing
mm-hmm.
the use of vaping.
There's so many right. factors right there, Professor.
Yeah.
Right?
I know.
It's quite similar to what happened with traditional cigarettes back in the days when it was first introduced,
yes.
where there was this Marlboro man that is considered as cool,
macho,
yeah. friendly, and then everybody wants to smoke the brand because
mm-hmm.
they want to be like this Marlboro man, a cowboy riding a horse, a very manly.
To imitate the figure that is right there branded by.
So there is a marketing strategy that
right.
lead to the misconception.
Which is a brilliant, we have to agree that it is a brilliant.
And because they want to sell.
Yes.
Yeah.
And again, with the hundreds of flavors now, when talking about flavors, hundreds of flavors, even the packaging is very colorful. Sometimes like, when you see it, of
very
course.
Very attractive.
Yes, for the user, you know, they are attracted to it. But this misconception that I am very interested to know, Prof, because you were saying the misconception of being of people thinking that it's healthier if you vape rather than, you know, the norm cigarettes. Why is it not healthier? Because there are some ingredients from the regular cigarettes that is not there in the vape. Mm.
It's not healthier. It's not safer.
Mm-hmm.
The correct term is that less harmful.
Okay. It is less harmful right. than a cigarette, a regular
exactly.
cigarette.
Because e-cigarette is still consists of nicotine,
mm-hmm.
addictive agent.
That's right.
And also some of chemical ingredient as well. Even though probably the quantity is less than the traditional cigarette smoke, but still, because you think this is safer, then you end up this youngster smoke it more and more and more. And at the end of the day, probably the quantity is even the same.
Yes.
And the impact is to the health, especially respiratory health, is also the same.
I think it's even more because it's more addictive because you don't have the smell of a regular smoke. Because people usually when they they like to smoke, but they don't like the smell.
Mm-hmm.
There are some people or some
community. But this smells
like
good.
Wait, but this one smells good, so you don't have time to like just, you know, take off of it because you can do it every time.
Yeah, and it tastes good as well.
Exactly.
And it tastes, you have different kind of flavors. You have cereals,
yes.
chocolate.
And different nicotines also, there's only 3%. Like, the percentage of the nicotine is also very different. Someone wants to feel more of a, like a real cigarette, you can have the higher nicotine, or you,
you
want
to... You can even have higher than a, a real cigarette.
Yes.
Even is, but still giving the same impact. Mm. Like you mentioned before that the youngster, the teenager from Klaten, getting pharyngitis.
Yes.
Like need to be admitted to the hospital four times a year, that is not a good condition.
Right. So, Prof, what are the long-term effects? I mean, we've we've been seeing this pharyngitis on this person from Klaten, and what are the other long-term effects on our, especially on the respiratory health?
Okay. So, all this chemical that being inhaled will have the impact of irritation first, irritation of the airway surface, and then in some condition it will develop inflammation. And inflammation means that the surface of the respiratory tract is swelling. And when the swelling is very massive all the way long, so it prevents the oxygen to pass to the lung. So it destroys the tract and also will make the parenchyma of the lung have inflammation as well, what so called pneumonia. For in the bronchial we call it bronchitis, in pharynx it call it pharyngitis. So sinusitis. So all these thing will happen. That's probably the acute short term impact. But the long term impact is that there will be a decreasing of lung function.
Oh my goodness. Right. Okay, so if you do this continuously for years.
Yeah, so you will get this COPD, chronic obstructive lung disease. This is very hard to breathe, and then it will trigger your asthma more frequently.
Right.
And then by the end of the day, probably even though less risk than tobacco, the risk of having cancer.
That's right.
It's still
but yes,
there.
I said it's less, but still there.
Yeah,
exactly.
You cannot say there's you are not prone to cancer because you're smoking electronic cigarette, because there are that chance. And anyways, we have to be all also very realistic. We're putting something inside, something chemical, something human made inside of us.
Yes,
that's right. And in regards to this, though, Prof, some people actually, our colleague Sarah was mentioning this to you before we begin our discussion right now, that there are some people taking, you know, taking the electronic cigarette as a substitute. Maybe they want to stop smoking cigarettes, and this is a substitute way, another way towards a no cigarette life.
Okay, I like this question. I've been meaning to say it to many people. Yeah, you are very correct. To tell you the truth, the electronic cigarette was designed initially to substitute the cigarette. But along the way, it proven doesn't work, and even more dangerous because people end up using both.
Right.
Yeah.
They
mean to quit smoking, move to vaping, but then actually they do both. At the end.
Right.
Of the day.
So if my vape is out, I'll take my regular cigarettes because it's right there in the convenience store, right?
Right.
So easy to get that.
So even the CDC from the US say that. Stop saying that e-cigarette can substitute the tobacco.
Tobacco.
It is not correct, and this is not happening. We fail to prove it.
Okay. And so that already mentioned by CDC. But can, if someone wants to do this as their way to stop, in how terms of period they should, you know, try the electronic cigarette. But it fails when if they feel, oh man, I'm like consumed with this again, they should just let it go.
Most are fail.
Most are fail, okay.
Most are fail, but few are succeeded.
Okay.
Quit smoking, but they need some time. Months or even years. Because the way they do it, like decreasing the number of cigarette smoke quantity.
Yes.
Yeah. But to stop entirely, that is very
It goes back to you, right, Prof?
Yeah. It's your willpower. Do you stop
exactly.
or not?
It's from here.
Yes, right.
Right. So, Prof, do you have maybe a tips for all of us who are currently hooked into electronic cigarettes and also other forms of e-cigarettes to how do we stop or how do we prevent ourselves from smoking it more?
To be addicted?
Yes. Or are we already?
First, you have to know that nicotine in tobacco or in electronic cigarette is addictive agent. You have to realize that. So if you want to stop, you have to stop from your heart, from your mind, and then let people know.
Yes.
Let people know, let your family know, so they can help.
Yeah. Mm.
And also, I think government should do something.
Absolutely.
There is a regulation on tobacco smoking, but there is no regulation on electronic smoking.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know, stop, do smoke, electronic smoke among around children or teenagers because they will follow. So
yes.
Please, parents, mom and dad, do not smoke in front of your child because they will follow. You know, the case of from Clayton, he has been smoking since 7.
Yes, yes.
He was a child when he started smoking.
It's and mirroring the parents, Prof.
Exactly, they will follow.
And I want to ask you in regards of the electronic cigarettes because we've seen, especially right here in Indonesia, people are usually, the common form is they use the vape or the electronic cigarettes inside the room. Back in the days, usually they have a separate, if you want to go have a cigarette, you have another room or maybe outdoors. But now you can do it indoors. How?
That is the thing, because there is no regulation on vaping or electronic cigarette.
Yeah.
People think that they can do it any place, anywhere, because there is no regulation. They said, oh, the free zone, smoking free zone is for the tobacco or cigarette. But not for the vaping.
How? What about the second smoker? I mean, because for cigarettes you have a second smoker, but for electronic cigarettes, is that such a term?
Yeah.
Is it dangerous for them to second smoke a vape?
It is similar. As long as you're still breathing,
okay.
Then you will get the same effect, even though maybe less.
Less than traditional cigarettes.
Yeah, but if you get exposure to it in the long term, you will be the same. It will be the same.
Right, because in some countries, I know for a fact in Singapore, it's electronic cigarette is banned from the country.
Yes,
100%. It is illegal for you to bring electronic cigarettes into the country and also to use and also to sell one.
Even in UK, they said it's illegal for e-cigarette for people under 18. And here, 7 years old starting. Smoke e-cigarette.
Yes.
It's this is very dangerous.
Yeah.
So it takes all parties, you know, including the government agencies, for all to work together.
Parents.
Prevention. Parents, definitely.
Teachers.
Regulations.
And I would like to recommend that the smoking, the impact of the smoking should be in the curriculum.
Okay.
So the student will.
It's a part of education.
Yeah. It's part of education. Yeah. The student will know the dangers of this cigarette smoking.
Yes.
Wow.
I wish.
Well, I mean, Professor, you already put it right there in the world, and hopefully, you know, we will hear it, and hopefully, universe will hear it too. Professor, it was such a great time. Listen, I mean, we will hope that we have more time with you, definitely. This is something, is a topic that is just widening the spectrum. There's so many, you know, questions that we need to
ask. Hey, we can do it in regular basis, actually.
That's right.
Part of education.
That's right.
You're right.
Yes.
Okay, so, Prof, thank you so much for coming with us in the studio and sharing with us the dangers of electronic cigarettes. And right, folks, we're going to have a short break. And after the break, so we have more updates just for you. So stay tuned with us.
Kayaknya lucu juga nih kalau dapur kita kasih warna. Nggak cuma warna coklat, warna putih. Yang ternyata emang berhasil naikin mood rumah ini sih.
Untuk jendela, pintu, dan furniturnya semuanya harus simple dan minimalis.
kalau misalnya bolongannya dari utara, itu pasti lebih banyak angin yang masuk.
Ready to score a touchdown?
Oh, I was born ready.
Let's go.
Let's go. Let's
go.
Gue yang penting apa yang gue makan bisa gue buang pada saat gue olahraga segitu.
Jadi Andilau kalau ketemu mungkin dia ketawa.
Dengan proses, gue bersyukur banget Kobe Junior tuh sempat bubar tahun 2016-2017.
Pilihnya sabu-sabu, karena sabu-sabu kita cuma makannya setahun sekali.
Kalau kita dengerin Spotify ya, Pak gimana sih caranya aku bisa masuk di sini gitu. Ya nggak boleh menghalangi lah.
The Indonesian state-owned enterprises ministry has underlined its commitment to supporting small and medium enterprises by launching vending machines at Soekarno-Hatta International Airport.
Qatar has advanced to the quarterfinals of the 2023 AFC Asian Cup after defeating Palestine 2-1 in the round of 16 at the Al Ayed Stadium in Al-Khor.
So we'll be back with the Danny Desert Entertainment.
See Indonesia, see the world, see today.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia!
Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Alright folks, you're back to the See Morning Show, and it's time for another update for you. And first up in the line, the Malay tribe in Sambas, West Kalimantan, often wears a fabric named Songket Sambas, which is made manually with a variety of motifs. Moreover, Songket Sambas has preserved through generations, thus becoming an inseparable part of the Malay tribe. Let's check this out.
Sambas Regency, located in West Kalimantan, boasts a signature woven fabric called Songket Sambas, which is popularized by the Malay tribe community. This fabric is a part of a local identity and has existed since the 17th century.
Ada pendapat mengatakan bahwa tenun Songket Sambas ini dimulai dari zaman kerajaan Sambas. Ada yang berpendapat dimulai dari Raja Sulaiman sekitar tahun 1600-an, dan ada juga pendapat lain mulai dari anak Raja Sulaiman sekitar 1600-an setelahnya.
Songket Sambas features a distinctive golden colored pattern with a regional fabric made of silk, giving it a luxurious appearance. And its motifs also hold a significant value.
Adanya songket ini, pengrajin itu harus membuat pola di dalam bentuk, kalau masyarakat Sambas menyebutnya itu sujibilang. Sujibilang itu adalah pola yang dibuat dari kotak-kotak yang dibuat pada kertas untuk dibuat motif-motif. Itu pola tiap kotak-kotak kecil itu menggambarkan piksel gitu ya. Pixel dalam gambar, jadi pola-pola tadi akan di translate atau dijabarkan ke dalam bentuk songket kain tenun. Untuk motif-motif lama yang masih digunakan itu masih banyak ya. Di antaranya yang bisa saya sebutkan adalah motif perang menang, ada juga motif mengkudu luruh atau motif mawar, motif pucuk rebung ya. Yang paling khas itu adalah pucuk rebung. Setiap song tenun songket sambas itu selalu dicirikan dengan adanya motif pucuk rebung di tengahnya atau tumpal gitu, kalau istilah bahasa Indonesia itu disana.
Many villagers in the Regency, including those in Sumber Harap Village, now possess weaving tools to produce songket fabric. This aims to preserve the weaving technique as part of cultural heritage, while embracing new innovations to its motifs.
Songket sambas itu sendiri beraneka ragam. Kalau kita perkirakan itu lebih dari 100 motif yang ada sampai sekarang ini. Dan terus berkembang karena pengrajin terus berinovasi dengan kombinasi-kombinasi motif gitu ya. Itu membuat aneka ragam motif itu semakin bervariasi. Yang menjadi penentu tingkat kesulitan songket itu ada yang dinamakan teknik songketnya ya. Karena tiap motif itu berbeda tingkat kesulitan membuatnya. Dari motif yang sederhana atau Suji bilang itu terdiri dari piksel-piksel tadi ya. Kalau di bahasa Sambas sendiri, piksel-piksel itu disebut karap. Ya, semakin banyak piksel yang diperlukan untuk membuat motif, maka kesulitan membuat motif itu akan semakin susah.
In the past, only one weaving artisan was needed to make a piece of songket sambas. But with the industrialization, job separation became inevitable. Despite still using wooden weaving tools, this process presents its own difficulties and challenges.
Menyiapkan benang ke dalam pleting. Proses menenunnya selama 10 hari sampai 20 hari. Tergantung banyaknya motif, kalau dia nak mau bagus, lebih banyak motifnya lebih bagus dia. Cuman sulit, lambat nenunnya.
The combination of creativity, manual weaving, and cultural values results in a relatively high price for songket sambas. One set of songket sambas consisting of various types of fabrics is sold at 2 to 3.5 million rupiahs. These woven fabrics are also distributed to neighboring countries.
Pemasaran kain songket sambas umumnya di Kalbar ya. Sekalbar sudah memang mengenal kain songket sambas, khususnya Kabupaten Sambas dan Singkawang gitu ya. Bahkan Pontianak dan Ketapang. Itu permintaan. Kalau di luar negeri biasanya Malaysia, yaitu Sarawak dan Brunei Darussalam. Itu namun untuk Brunei biasanya motif yang dipesan itu merupakan motif mereka sendiri. Hanya pengerjaan yang di sambas.
Songket sambas has not only become part of a Malay tribe's identity in this regency, but also symbolizes the unity of this tribe under the same ancestor. This is because a Malay tribe also resides in the cross-border region of Southeast Asia. See Today News contributor reporting from Sambas Regency, West Kalimantan.
It is indeed a beautiful piece of fabric from the Sambas Regency. And now the Parigi Motong Regency in Central Sulawesi is not just known for its stunning natural beauty, but it also presents promising opportunities in the agricultural sector. For instance, the Buranga village, one of the many villages in the area. Now here, local residents have managed to harvest up to 30 tons of durian in a single harvest season. Let's check this out.
Local residents in Buranga village, Parigi Motong Regency Central Sulawesi, have been developing durian farming. This endeavor is supported by soil conditions, weather patterns, and advancements in technology, which contribute to enhancing quality of the fruit.
Kalau memang bagus musim, ini tergantung faktor musim, Pak. musim. Biasa kalau saya kalau sekali panen sekitar mencapai 30 ton ya, sekali panen. Kalau itu iklim bagus.
Setahun berapa kali panen itu?
Ini ada buah antara, Pak. Biasa satu tahun dua kali, tapi buah antara satu kali. Panen rayanya satu kali juga. Nah, itu yang banyak panen raya.
Not only locally, durian from this regency is now starting to spread to a number of areas in Indonesia.
Kalau untuk pemasaran, ini memang sudah sampai keluar, jadi pemasaran kita sudah sampai di Jakarta dari Parigimotong, dan itu dilakukan oleh para kerajaan kita.
Tantangannya apa, Pak, terakhir?
Saya kira ini memang, kalau untuk tantangan, di samping yang kita sudah bahas tadi, ini mungkin tata niaganya juga perlu barangkali dibenahi ke depan, karena ini berkaitan dengan bagaimana menjaga stabilitas harga pada saat misalnya panen raya.
Not only farmers, but investors are also interested in this sector because it offers good investment opportunities. However, farmers need government's help with basic things like water and fertilizer to keep improving their yields. Citadel contributor reporting from Parigimotong Regency Central Sulawesi.
Now, who doesn't love a durian from Parigi? Hi folks, and right now we're going to have a quick break, and after that, Carol will return with a recap of some update news. So stay tuned with us only on the C Morning Show.
Kayaknya lucu juga nih kalau dapur kita kasih warna, nggak cuma warna coklat, warna putih, yang ternyata emang berhasil naikin mood rumah ini sih.
Untuk jendela, pintu, dan furniturnya semuanya harus simple dan minimalis.
Kalau misalnya bolongannya dari utara, itu pasti lebih banyak angin yang masuk.
Gue yang penting apa yang gue makan bisa gue buang pada saat gue olahraga, segitu.
Jadi Abila kalau ketemu mungkin dia ketawa. Gitu.
Dengan proses, gue bersyukur banget kubu junior tuh sempat bubar tahun 2016-2017.
Pilihnya sabu-sabu, karena sabu-sabu kita cuma makannya setahun sekali.
Kalau kita dengerin Spotify, Pak gimana sih caranya aku bisa masuk di sini ke gitu. Ya nggak boleh menghalangi lah.
The Indonesian State-Owned Enterprises Ministry has underlined its commitment to supporting small and medium enterprises by launching vending machines at Soekarno-Hatta International Airport.
Qatar has advanced to the quarterfinals of the 2023 AFC Asian Cup after defeating Palestine 2-1 in the round of 16 at the Al Ayed Stadium in Al-Khor.
So we'll be back with the Danny Desert Entertainment.
See Indonesia, see the world, see today.
Selamat malam pemirsa See Today. Kita ketemu lagi di Ngonten, ngobrolin tentang Nusantara.
Bisa digandrong gandring, Chris empuk gandring.
Iya, itu dia. Chris
empuk gandring. Amin ya. Jadi itu apa ini?
Dari mana? Kira menurut kamu ini daerah mana? Dari daerah mana? Dari negara lain ini?
Malaysia.
Dari China?
Bukan.
India?
Bukan. Asia Tenggara aja boleh gak? Namanya See Today. See Today Southeast Asian.
Ke Binjai mau migrasi.
Cakep.
Anjay aku deport sih.
Ya aku cuma mau bilang hari ini kamu tuh cantik loh.
Aduh ya Allah. Kali ini.
Oke lah kalau penampilan dia enggak sebaik itu, enggak sebagus itu, enggak seganteng itu, tapi tuh hatinya dia sebaik itu dan tidak ada orang yang pernah gue temuin hatinya sebaik Mars.
Pemain.
Figur publik kok kere.
Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Apa sih yang mencari? Bini setuju aja?
Harus setuju, saya jadi badut.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya gitu, bikin.
Bikin pesawat
gitu.
Sim salabim.
Abrakadabra.
Singgobangkosir.
Pala botak gak bisa disisir.
Pala botak gak bisa.
Hello everyone.
everyone. Welcome back to the program. We've been reporting about what is happening in the United Arab Emirates and how it's trying to wring itself out Thursday after the heaviest recorded rainfall ever to hit the desert nation, with its main airport allowing more flights. And the flooding sparked speculation that the UAE's aggressive campaign of cloud seeding, flying small planes through clouds, dispersing chemicals aimed at getting rain to fall, may have contributed to the deluge. However, experts said the storm system that produced the rain were forecast well in advance, and that cloud seeding alone would not have caused such floodings.
Not only rescuing people, police officers in Dubai rescued a cat during an unprecedented rainstorm that hit the United Arab Emirates. The black and white cat was seen clinging to the handle of a car in flood water on Wednesday. By the end of Tuesday, more than 142 millimeters or 5.5 inches of rainfall had soaked Dubai over 24 hours. The UAE's drainage systems quickly became overwhelmed, flooded out neighborhoods, business districts, and even portions of the 12-lane Sheikh Zayed Road highway running through Dubai. Dubai International Airport, the world's busiest for international travel, has allowed global carriers to again fly into Terminal 1 at the airfield. However, Dubai Airport CEO Paul Griffiths said that the airfield needed at least another 24 hours to resume operations close to its usual schedule. The airport ended up needing 22 tankers with vacuum pumps to get water off its grounds.
The real issues, I think, started on Tuesday when the storm cells came across from Saudi Arabia, and we were looking at the radar thinking, goodness, if this hits, then it's going to be cataclysmic. And indeed it was.
Long-haul carrier Emirates, crucial to east-west travel, has begun allowing local passengers to arrive at Terminal 3, their base of operations.
When, of course, the check-in moratorium expired, that's when everyone came to the airport in an attempt to get on flights. So I think we had more than 2,000 people in T3 getting to rebook their flights and getting checked in and away. I was there about 12 p.m. today, and it was extremely busy, but I think the customers were, you know, good-humoured. They accept the situation. They realise that we can't control the weather.
Emirates, whose operations had been struggling since the storm Tuesday, had stopped travelers flying out of the UAE from checking into their flights as they tried to move out connecting passengers. Pilots and flight crews also had a hard time reaching the airport given the water on the roadways. On Thursday, Emirates lifted that order to allow customers into the airport. That saw some 2,000 people come into Terminal 3, again sparking long lines. Some travelers who arrived in Dubai describe hours-long waits to get their baggage, with some just giving up to head home or to whatever hotel would have them.
And to know more of what is happening on the ground and also the recent updates from Dubai, we are already connected with an Indonesian citizen, Ira Menikcini, and that is residing in Dubai. Good morning, Ira.
Hi, good morning, Ba.
Hi, good morning, Ira. Thank you so much for being here with us. We know that it's still in the early wee hours on your side of the pond, but thank you so much for being here with us and elaborating the situation that is happening right now in Dubai. But how are you this morning, and how's the situation thus far in your surrounding area?
Yeah, this morning I should say, because I live in the business district area, mm-hmm. since yesterday, what can I see that is resume almost normal. So
okay.
Delivery services is open, the restaurant is open, and the groceries restock, which is important.
Mm-hmm.
And I see that some of employees is already resume back to the office. And also, from what I see from my window, fortunately, I can see the metro is already reached to my area where we live. So I believe today's will be much better.
And
maybe 90% resume normal. So, I hope so.
And definitely, you know, it seems as a very fast response from the Dubai government and trying to put everything back into normalcy. But I know
it is
quite hard maybe to kind of go back and to reminisce in what happened on Thursday the 18th. But if you don't mind, please do share with us and elaborate the ongoing during that day and take us through the journey, what you saw and what you've also witnessed.
Okay, I should start with the during 4 years, Dubai is doing, as Mbak already mentioned, a cloud seeding. Mm-hmm. It's in hope, cloud seeding is in hope to cooling the weather during the summer and also to conserve some water. So actually that is a positive result for us here who live in Dubai. And then at the time, we start receiving warning from the authority on Saturday. They say that there will be adverse weather during Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday. So we're all thinking like, oh, this is another cloud seeding. Oh, that's fine. You mm-hmm. know, it's like happened like 2 weeks ago during the weekend. It's rainy, but coming from Indonesia, as you know, we got so many rains.
Yes.
So like, fine, it's another rain days, right? So on Sunday, we start to getting like more warning, which is, oh, what is going on? There's so much warning. And then, of course, we knew what is going on in Oman and Saudi Arabia with the adverse weather there. And then during Monday, some of friends who are having minor children, they got a message from the school. School is holiday or online, remote schooling. Mm-hmm. And also some of husband of my friend received suggestion for work from home. Then we just, okay, this is must be more serious than usual. Mm-hmm. But still, you know, it's fine. My husband still working, still going to work on Tuesday morning.
Okay.
So he's working in Abu Dhabi in a military base. So then again, I woke up by early morning around 1 a.m. The wind start very strong.
Okay.
So I start to secure some of furniture in the balcony. Thanks, yeah. And then after that, sleep. And by in the morning, I woke up very dark situation. Mm-hmm. Wow, like what is going on? And then the wind start by 8:21, something like that. So strong wind. And you can see like there is a tree on surrounding my apartment. It's moving very fast,
yeah.
That's the indicator. And then by 8:30, the rain start pouring. Okay, this is happening. I start to messaging my husband, so what's going on? And she said, oh, a little bit challenging on the roads, mm-hmm. but he managed to get the base. And then that's after that. So I thought that everything is over and start receiving message, oh, how are you guys doing? Start messaging my friend, oh, we are okay. We thought it's only one. And then again, by 3 p.m., another, we call it storm, Tom,
yeah.
Because it's never happened before. And some of friends sending some videos showing in their house there is a hailstorm, ice.
Yes.
Ice cube start pouring, and then after that, that is really when the media, social, and the video starts circulating between us. The road starting flooding, and the metro, and the Dubai Mall, some of store, and Mall the Emirates also, and we start shock. All of us like shock back then. Okay, but then again, there's another, they inform us another rainy, heavy rain will be hit us around 7 p.m. And by 7 p.m., we are like, oh, my God, this is happening. Mm-hmm. We are just like, okay. My apartment is secure. Thanks, yeah. There's nothing happening inside the apartment. But I'm running around checking here and there. Make sure the all window is secure, no water, what is that?
Leaking in.
Dropping,
yes.
Something like that, leaking mm-hmm. in. But unfortunately, a friend who stay in a villa, we call it villa, mm-hmm. although it's an infected house, they start to inform us, oh, we got like leaking. It's not a little leaking. I'm telling you, it's just like water pouring from the roof. Because the way they made the villa here, there's nothing like, for us, we have like, on top of roof, we have like triangle, right?
Yes.
So when the water come, it's will be draining or...
There are water flow.
Goes directly, drainage. Water flow. So. But here, unfortunately, because this is desert anyway, never been designed for such weather. Mm-hmm. But then again, thanks, Kia. There's no one of my friend or Indonesian living in Dubai here reportedly,
casualties and victims. Yes.
Yes, there's thanks, Kia, for that. And then it's only some furniture and cars. Of course, that's unfortunate, but then again, that's not really matter. It comes to life, right? Mm-hmm. So as you see, there's a lot of cars being abandoned on the street. Doesn't really matter the big car or the fancy car, mm-hmm. what we call such big car. Again, it's about the life. Mm-hmm. Some of friends also who's on duty that day, been trapped on the street, including my husband to that extent level. But thanks God, my husband managed to get home around 6 p.m. Mm-hmm. That's just the whole, my worries that day, you know. I'm checking all my friends, are you guys okay? How's your situation? How's your husband? How's the house? That is what happened on Tuesday. But then again, we should give credit to the local authority here.
Yes.
How they, the fast response from them, you know, mm-hmm. pump out the water and the give clear direction which area needs to be avoided, which route that you can as alternate if you are trapped, and then all the emergency numbers, they circulated in the media. So that's, I'm still thinking like, thanks God I live here in the UAE, in Dubai in particular.
Yes. No, Ira, I mean, of course, we're thankful and very also blissful seeing you and your family are all safe, and also your loved ones and colleagues and friends. In regards to this, it seems that everything is back to normalcy in Dubai. I mean, we can see, you know, the sun is a little bit coming up to a rise right now from your windows. Can you share with us how the weather is right now outside of your apartment? And you were saying before that, and also we see on the reports, on the footages, that there's a lot of cars that's been abandoned. What are the law enforcement, also the government officials, are doing right now to, you know, clean the area and also to have, you know, back the traffic back into normalcy? It seems because everything is doing better today as though than 2 days ago.
Today's weather forecast is will be sunny and nice. And then please remember, is we are still in a winter, what we call here. Mm-hmm. So weather will be like 20 to 25 Celsius. That's nice weather, actually. Yesterday, actually, there's some road still blocked by the water. So some still inaccessible, but there is an alternate route. The government working, from what I read, from what I heard, working very hard, like 24 hours. Mm-hmm. You won't believe it how they do that. They pump out the Sheikh Zayed road, which is the highway, the main road here, is almost clear now and almost resume normal. So that is the busiest road here in Dubai. For what I can see today, before I sit here, I sneak peek outside the window. Sheikh Zayed is really back busy, and then. For the cars that being abandoned, from what I read the news yesterday, the government or the authority urged the people to clear out or to clear their the abandoned cars from the street. You know, so I see now, so the car, the tow car, they clean up all the cars who's being abandoned. On Wednesday, we still seen cars mm-hmm. being on the street, you know, but I think today it's probably, or I'm sure it will be clear.
And
perhaps we will resume normal.
Definitely, and it seems that imminent and fast response and the diligence by the local government is making everything just so fast right now to everyone to feel back and in their safe haven and going back to a normal life. And we are very grateful that Ira and also your husband and your family are doing all well, thankfully and godfully, and we wish you definitely all the best. And it seems that right now the sun is uprising, and hopefully you have a great day and days ahead. Thank you very much, Ira, for spending
your
time
here
with us.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Baba.
Thank you for sharing your journey.
Thank you, Baba. Thank you. Thank you, Baba.
That was Ira Minikini, an Indonesian citizen that is residing in United Arab Emirates, that sharing the story of the floods that has just happened 2 days ago, and it's severe rainfall and flooding in the past 75 years. Now, we also have some natural disaster that we would like to share with you, coming right here from Indonesia, where lahar flow from Mount Semeru has displaced hundreds in Lumajang Regency. Thursday's flow, triggered by hours of heavy rain, also destroyed bridges connecting four districts. The affected are residents of villages along three local rivers, Rajali, Glidik, and Mujur. There were close to a dozen tremors detected as well. And elsewhere in Banten, the overflow from Lake Cilumbun has affected dozens of homes and left streets waterlogged, with water levels reaching a meter in some parts. The affected has evacuated to higher grounds. Our next update is Colonel Ardi Syahri is the Air Force new information chief. He has replaced Air Commodore Bambang Junior, who assumes commands of Adi Sumarno Air Base. In the welcoming reception on Thursday, Colonel Ardi highlighted building strong connection with the media and social media platforms as his agenda and priority. This, he believes, will support and promote the programs laid out by the new Air Force chief, Air Chief Marshal Tony Harjono. And Ardi's first major task will be converge of the Air Force 78th anniversary celebration that will commence in Yogyakarta.
Yang terpenting adalah dari kasau itu kita harus membuka komunikasi strategis dengan para media sosial, para kru, untuk apa ya, membuka silaturahim dalam rangka mengekspos TNI Angkatan Udara ke depan. Ya, utamanya untuk setelah menjadikan TNI Angkatan Udara itu disegani di kawasan, ini sekarang kasau yang baru mencetuskan program ampuh, ya ampuh. Nah, inilah ke depan program yang saya akan laksanakan ke depan.
And everyone, we're set for our last break of the day. Next up, we will have Sarah and Archie coming back for our last entertainment update. Stay tuned right here on the C Morning Show. We'll be right back.
Welcome to City Day Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
City Day Business.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia! Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
The Indonesian State-owned Enterprises Ministry has underlined its commitment to supporting small and medium enterprises by launching vending machines at Soekarno-Hatta International Airport.
Qatar has advanced to the quarterfinals of the 2023 AFC Asian Cup after defeating Palestine 2-1 in the round of 16 at the Al Ayed Stadium in Al-Khor.
So we'll be back with the Danny Desert Entertainment.
See Indonesia, see the world, see today.
Bye.
This is the situation at kilometer 414.
This morning experienced the crossing situation from Bakaheni Lampung to Merak Banten, and we didn't experience any traffic from Bakahuni until we arrived in Merak Banten.
Jasa Marga predicts the peak of return flow on Eid al-Fitr celebration takes place on April 15, 2024.
Kenapa nama TPG ini berdiri? Kalau bahasa kayak kita tuh nama panggilannya tuh lebih gampang tuh panggil Aji tuh TPG. TPG itu kan panggil tuh Mak Gendut. Resepnya turun menurun. Nah, sedangkan saya baru ke generasi kedua.
Alright folks, you're back with us with the C Morning Show, and this is our last segment of the day, and it means that this is entertainment news. So good news for all of you Swifties, as Taylor Swift dropped a library pop-up installation in Los Angeles to promote her upcoming album, The Tortured Poets Department, that will be released this Friday or today.
Yes, Taylor Swift teamed up with Spotify for a special library installation pop-up at The Grove in Los Angeles this week, featuring carefully curated items regarding the Cruel Summer Singer's new album. The installation consists of a display of books which have hidden messages about Swift's upcoming songs, as well as some lyrics on the paper, a globe that pinned in Florida, and 72 drawers which fans believe to be about her relationship with Joe Alwyn. This installation was open from April the 16th until 18th yesterday, and it was running from 10 a.m. until 9 p.m. each and every day of the week at that time.
When did she stop, by the way? My gosh. Now, aside from dropping an installation, Swift also uploaded a short video on her Instagram account announcing the release date for her new album and new music video. Her account also has a hidden feature where fans can see a countdown of her upcoming album release. So people are still right now, right, on the Swifties kind of mode after the concert, 6 days in Singapore, everywhere elsewhere in the world, and now she's coming out with this, so.
Absolutely.
People are just not gonna stop.
Brilliant, right?
Yeah.
Brilliant.
This weekend, today is the album, or the 19th of Friday, and then tomorrow will be the music video.
My goodness.
Swifties weekend indeed.
That's right, money-making machine. And with Swift's next album dropped just days away, a building in Chicago's River North neighborhood now sports a QR code and the words Taylor Swift, the Tortured Poets Department, painted on its side.
Keeping with Swift's tradition of using cryptic messages and Easter eggs leading up to album and music video releases, the mural has various letters which appears to be T, P, and D, and the number 13 displayed on it.
The mural did not appear to be completely completed on Tuesday afternoon, and scaffolding was blocking it partially. The QR code takes fans to a short on Swift's YouTube account, which reads, Error 321.
Now, several were gathered near the building about noon Tuesday, trying to scan the code and decipher the message. The Tortured Poets Department will be released Friday today. Certainly something Swifties around the world would want to miss. And you know, for some people that is in my generation, maybe we're not Swifties, but our children are. So with that said,
I was that light.
Yeah, we gotta be jumping in the wagon, right? It's like, okay, and it's really entertaining, of course, and her music is very easy listening, and the stories behind her song.
Like, yes.
You know, what message is she trying to convey with her song?
Absolutely, and the connection with her fans.
Yes.
I mean, with the bracelets, with the messages, the cryptic Easter eggs popping out each and everywhere. So it's like a puzzle kind
of
way.
It's brilliant, I think.
Yeah.
Absolutely. And also, for now, you K-pop fans will also want to mark August 10th on their calendar because EXO's Suho is coming for a solo concert here in Jakarta.
Yes, he will hold the show, dubbed Suho Concert, Su Home in Jakarta, at the Tennis Indoor Senayan. However, no words yet from the promoter, Messima Pro, on ticketing details and also seating arrangements.
It will be a part of a series of concerts which kicks off on July the 25th and 26th in Seoul. The shows will take place in the Philippines, Hong Kong, and Taipei, among other places as well. there's just so many K-pop artists that is coming to Indonesia just in 2024.
Well, Indonesia is a cash cow.
Definitely.
All these Korean artists.
And why would you have a post-holiday blues when you have to work hard for all these tickets?
Absolutely, absolutely.
Now, we're going to go somewhere that is more into a general generation, because for the first time in over 50 years, a documentary film on the Beatles from 1970, Let It Be, will drop on May the 8th on Disney Plus.
The Beatles documentary film Let It Be, produced in 1970, is scheduled for release on May 8th. The documentary will be premiered after being restored for the first time in decades. The release announcement was made on the Beatles' social media accounts, confirming that Let It Be will be available for streaming on Disney Plus. Directed by Michael Lindsay Hogg, the documentary chronicles the band's journey from rehearsals to recording sessions for their 12th and final studio album, Let It Be, in January 1969.
In a new motion picture.
However, the film disappeared from official circulation since the 1980s and was only available through illegal bootleg copies. Let It Be was also previously considered for release on DVD and Blu-ray formats, but those plans never materialized. Eventually, Lord of the Rings director Peter Jackson gained access to restore the documentary, with the process carried out by Park Road Post-Production.
When we lost John, we knew that it was really over.
Let It Be is not the only Beatles work released decades after its creation. The band previously launched their final song titled Now and Then on November 2nd, 2023.
It's the last song that my dad and Paul and George and Ringo will get to make together.
How lucky was I to have those men in my life?
Well, I mean, the Beatles has been popping up too, not only on Disney Plus, it was also, you know, there's Netflix also came up, Stories,
yeah.
And Amazon Prime. What do you think about that, Archie, and also Sarah?
I love it.
I mean, yes.
You'll be waiting for this, as we discussed earlier, yes.
This morning, that, I mean, the Beatles is, especially news about the Beatles, are something that I'm always looking forward to.
Yeah.
It's, because, first of all, they're a legend, obviously.
Yes,
and second of all, they're long gone. Mm-hmm. So any news, any kind of news is, I think, a good news.
Yes, they're definitely a part of history of mankind.
And then all generations can actually, you know, relate to their songs and then how it inspires a lot of musicians as well.
Yes.
And I think that's the magic of it.
That's
it transcends throughout all the generations.
Yes. And it's good right now, they make it also into like a visual and, you know, episodes and all this.
And it's streamed, so we can watch it anywhere and anytime when it's convenient for us, right?
Definitely, and why not you do it during the weekends, right? Because we're now stepping into the weekend. Well, actually later at 3 a.m., 4, 5 a.m.
We're almost there.
We're almost there. But hopefully that you did had a great morning being here with Archie, Sarah, and also myself on the C Morning Show for the past 3 hours. So hopefully our information is enlightening and also inspiring for you. As always, a pleasure to bring you your morning dose news right here on the C Morning Show. And be sure to also follow us on our social media through Instagram, X.com, and our YouTube channel at C Today News.
Yes, and C Today can now be enjoyed in Australia on Foxtel's Flash app, or in Macau Cable TV Channel 84. Or if you're in the Philippines, you can also watch at Converge Vision Channel 58 and at Singapore and Singtel Singapore Channel 15 and StarHub Channel 720.
For Telkomsel users, you can also watch See Today on the Max Stream and My Telkomsel app. Don't forget to also tune in again tomorrow, same time, same channel, and be sure to catch our afternoon show every day at 5 p.m. I'm Sarah Wayne.
I'm Archie Pramaswara.
And I'm Caroline Saramat. Have a blissful and grateful Monday. Friday, not Monday. Monday is a couple of days. All right, guys.
All right.
See Indonesia. See the world. See today. I butchered that.
Bye.
Almost stopped.
Tamu saya ini disebut sebagai salah satu legenda sepak bola Indonesia. Kalau legenda biasanya udah gak main, tapi yang ini living and playing legend. Jadi dia masih bermain. Dikenal sebagai petualang di sepak bola ya. Kalau yang lain-lain itu nanti urusan yang lain ya. Karena sudah memperkuat klub-klub di Indonesia dari Sumatera sampai mana-mana. Sosoknya berkarisma. Sampai back tuh suka akhirnya kasih dia buat golin dong, gading. Selalu jadi kapten di tiap klub yang dia bela. Garang di dalam, tapi lembut di luar lapangan. Siapa dia? Langsung kita gaskan dia. YouTuber sepak bola nomor satu, Hamka Hamzah. Weesh. Dan juga bersama Cap yang sudah tepuk tangan tadi gak disebut.
Astagfirullahaladzim.
Ada Ate.
Ya, saya Coach Justin. Saya...
Bukan dong.
Style-nya.
Bukan. Jangan, bukan. Nanti bukan. Kamu banyak bukan. Yang benci. Kalau kamu sama Coach Justin. Ada Ate di sini karena kamu ngapain Ate?
Ini ditugasin katanya buat nemenin, takutnya Bung Valen nanyanya suka kemana-mana.
Oh okay, gitu.
Ini gue yang jagain lu nih.
Oh lu jagain gue?
Jagain.
Karena Ate si paham dan si paling bola.
Iya gue bola banget bang, gua yeah. dari lahir udah bola banget gue.
Iya, yeah, iya. Yeah. Ate tapi ini ya.
Apa?
Sekarang roastingan lu makin dikenal luas.
Udah mulai-mulai ke yang politik-politik gue sekarang.
Udah masuk ke situ ya?
Udah masuk ke situ.
Harga mulai naik.
Harga mulai naik sama nyali mulai turun ya.
Oh iya. Nah ini cocok.
Cocok.
Ngomong-ngomong soal nyali mulai turun.
Uh-uh.
Kalau Cap ini nyalinya makin kesini makin naik.
Nah.
Karena waktu kemarin itu ketika akhirnya Liga 1 dilanjutin tapi Liga 2 menggantung. Mm. Cap Hamka ini mencari keadilan kemana-mana. Ya kan Cap?
Iya bang.
Itu emang karena lu bilang periuk nasi pemain atau memang waktunya memang pas aja buat seorang Cap Hamka ini untuk bisa menyuarakan apa yang dirasakan juga oleh banyak pemain waktu itu?
Kalau saya inisiatif saya sendiri bang. Hmm. Karena melihat sepak bola kok diputuskan dengan sepihak.
Ya.
Toh yang... yang terjadi di Liga 1 semuanya stop ya. Karena kita berempati. Tapi kelanjutannya kok Liga 1 yang dijalankan, Liga 2 dan Liga 3 malah di stop. Nah ini alasannya juga gak masuk akal karena kehabisan biaya katanya LIB.
Waktu itu ya.
Waktu itu. Akhirnya saya bicara ke pemilik FC Bekasi, abang masih mau berjuang, kalau berjuang saya yang maju. Akhirnya Bang Putra bilang, ya Cap, saya masih mau berjuang karena biar bagaimanapun pemilik klub juga banyak mengeluarkan duit bang.
Betul.
Apalagi seawal-awalnya itu saya melihat posisi.
Oke. Okay.
Posisi FC Bekasi itu,
waktu itu
punya kesempatan untuk kesempatan besar dengan tim-tim yang ada di peringkat satu di wilayah yang lain juga. Cuma kesini-sininya sudah gak berpikir seperti itu. Karena yang saya lihat kok enak bener ya Liga Satunya jalan. Kita malah suruh nonton mereka. Dan di situ saya bicara dengan teman-teman APPI, saya hubungi ketuanya Andre Tani, saya bilang, "Ini pemain-pemain Liga 1 ini mau berjuang apa? Mau melihat kita yang Liga 2, Liga 3 ini diem aja." Gak Cap, ini juga kita berjuang. Aku nah, waktu itu kalau dia enggak bilang kita ini masih nunggu, saya serang juga mereka. Gitu.
Tapi jadi, akhirnya dia bilang mau berjuang ya, juga.
Berjuang juga. Untung itu lewat itu. melalui organisasi mereka.
Ya, itu
sih. Kalau enggak mau berjuang diceng-cengin tuh ya di
ya bukan apa? Jadi
di WhatsApp kayak apa lu cuma
kalau enggak mau berjuang ya
apa?
Apa ya? Yes.
Enggak ada solidaritas dong.
Oke.
Sama pemain.
Tapi Liga 2 juga profesional berarti kan anggota PPI juga kan?
Ada beberapa yang anggota PPI.
Okay.
Jadi masuk APPI itu mempunyai kartu anggota ya. Di anggota PPI. Saya aja belum jadi anggota
PPI. Oh belum ya?
Tapi bagian rusuh.
Tapi ada kartu anggota keluarga ada?
Ada.
Kalau itu aman gak
apa-apa. Kalau itu gak ada bahaya deh.
Iya itu bahaya itu ya.
Gak bisa pulang. Ya.
Tapi yang gue penasaran itu kan baru-baru ini ketua PSSI udah baru nih.
Baru.
Nah, menurut Bang Hamka itu gimana tuh dengan... Itu tuh orang Lampung juga tuh satu kampung sama gua.
Menteri BUMN.
Iya.
Oh iya.
Kan itu Eto ini Ate. Oh, Itu.
Enak kalau ngomong eta aja
lu ya. Kan panggilannya loh, panggilannya.
Yang punya situ deh.
Ya itu, ya kan makanya gue mau tahu nih pendapat Bang Hamka.
Kalau sekarang sih belum kita bisa menilai ya, karena baru berapa bulan liga juga belum jalan, timnas juga hanya beliau meneruskan pengurus yang sebelumnya. Jadi kita belum bisa menilai lah. Okay. Saya sebagai pemain belum bisa menilai ketua umum yang baru karena baru berapa bulan menjabat.
Tapi perjuangan waktu akhirnya sampai ke keputusan itu kan Cap juga update terus tuh.
Yeah.
Ya kan bahwa dilanjutkan atau tidak dilanjutkan, kemudian juga akan dimulai lagi kapan gitu. Waktu itu kan akhirnya diputuskan dalam rapat ya.
Rapat.
Dan Cap Hamka tuh update terus, makanya kita bisa lihat terus juga. Waktu memperjuangkan itu seperti apa tuh sulitnya, Cap? Maksudnya apakah lu ketemu juga dengan pihak-pihak yang memang mencoba untuk meredakan lu, untuk gak, jangan ngomong deh, jangan vokal dan segala
macam itu? Gak ada sih.
Gak ada.
Justru saya menunggu. Menunggu siapa yang mau menyuruh saya untuk stop. Jangan terlalu vokal.
Gak ada.
Kalau ada yang nyuruh, saya gas sekalian mereka.
Gaskan dia.
Itu saya tunggu-tunggu memang. Saya tunggu-tunggu. Ada oknum-oknum kali ya yang bilang, Cap, tolong ditahan-tahan. Saya tunggu memang. Tapi sampai saat keputusan itu gak ada. Tapi, makanya saya bilang, saya jalan terus. Karena apa? Kita bukan melakukan sesuatu yang melanggar. Tapi ini hak kita pemain Liga 2 dan Liga 3. Jadi teman-teman juga semua mendukung. Dia bilang ya, ini jalan benar ini Bang. Kalau memang ada yang melarang-melarang ya, paling diserang masyarakat mereka.
Oh. Itu sih. Ini emang ini Teh, karena urusannya ini kan masih ada pertandingan yang pertama.
Yeah.
Kedua kan juga penghasilan.
Yeah.
Nah ketika penghasilan tiba-tiba di stop, misalnya lu kan roasting orang, lagi laku-lakunya, gak taunya ada satu yang gak terima. Akhirnya lu di blacklist di mana-mana.
Yeah.
Kan puyeng lu.
Puyeng, gue mau dari mana lagi ya kan?
Ya kan?
Duitnya dari ngomongin orang ya. Tapi kalau Bang Hamka ini terlalu vokal gini, udah ada yang ini gak ngajak nge-band?
Vokal ya.
Bukan.
Gue kira lu mau nanya.
Apa?
Cap ini terlalu vokal, ada yang nge-backup kagak nih?
Gua kira gitu. Itu bisa jadi. Tapi belum tentu. Jawabannya sendiri apa itu?
Ada backup-an Cap?
Ada. Kalau backup-an gak ada. Karena saya bilang dari awal ini saya jalan di jalan yang benar. Jadi backup-an saya yang teman-teman pecinta sepak bola yang ingin melanjutkan kemarin melihat kelanjutan Liga 2 dan Liga 3. Karena saya bertemu dengan beberapa pengurus waktu meeting bahwa saya bilang saya kenal beliau semua.
Betul.
Nah, cuman karena ini tempat saya mencari nafkah ya, rezeki di pas lagi Liga 2. Ya saya maju Pak, saya bilang. Walaupun keputusannya apa ya saya berjuang dulu.
Paknya tuh siapa nih?
Ada beberapa pengurus seperti Ketua LIB, Pak Ferry, terus Pak Sekjen.
Oh, iya.
Itu kan saya kenal semua, esko-eskonya pun saya kenal semua. Jadi saya minta maaf sebelumnya. Karena saya bilang ya saya berjuang Pak. Dan itu saya berjuang bukan karena rezeki saya stop, Bekasi lancar.
Tetap jalan.
Tetap jalan. Cuma teman-teman yang lain dan saya pribadi melihat bahwa enak-enak yang mereka jalan kita. Itu sih. Tapi, dan itu keputusannya diambil bukan yang
diomongin.
Nah, seperti yang kejadian kayak contoh di Kanjuruan ya, itu kalau stop ya saya mau ngapain, yang ada saya diserang masyarakat. Tapi ini kan di stop
sepihak
gitu loh Bang. Dan ya, beberapa tim yang ingin melanjutkan akhirnya bertambah. Itu.
Yang di Liga 2 kemarin.
Yang di Liga 2 kemarin.
Kayaknya lucu juga nih kalau dapur kita kasih warna, nggak cuma warna coklat, warna putih, yang ternyata emang berhasil naikin mood rumah ini sih.
Untuk jendela, pintu, dan furniturnya semuanya harus simple dan minimalis.
Kalau misalnya bolongannya dari utara, itu pasti lebih banyak angin yang masuk.
ready to score a touchdown?
Oh, I was born ready.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Apa yang gue makan bisa gue buang pada saat gue olahraga segitu.
Jadi Abila kalau ketemu mungkin dia ketawa tuh.
Dengan proses, gue bersyukur banget Kobe Junior tuh sempat bubar tahun 2016-2017.
Pilihnya sabu-sabu, karena sabu-sabu kita cuma makannya setahun sekali.
Kalau kita dengerin Spotify ya, Pak gimana sih caranya aku bisa masuk di sini ke gitu. Ya nggak boleh menghalangi lah.
The Indonesian state-owned enterprises ministry has underlined its commitment to supporting small and medium enterprises by launching vending machines at Soekarno-Hatta International Airport.
Qatar has advanced to the quarterfinals of the 2023 AFC Asian Cup after defeating Palestine 2-1 in the round of 16 at the Al Ayed Stadium in Al-Khor.
So we'll be back with the Danny Desert Entertainment.
See Indonesia, see the world, see today.
Absolutely delicious.
You know, it's actually pretty good.
Satu, dua, tiga.
Indonesia! Come see the nature, only on See Indonesia.
Come see the beauty, only on See Indonesia.
Only on See Indonesia.
Figur publik kok kere.
Perlombaan ini tuh seperti mendaki Everest 3 kali.
Apa sih yang dicari? Bini setuju aja?
Harus setuju, saya jadi batu.
Siapa sih yang ngajarin kamu sekuat ini?
Ada Pak Habibie katanya gitu, bikin.
Bikin pesawat.
Bikin pesawat gitu.
Simsalabim.
Simsalabim.
Abrakadabra.
Abrakadabra.
Singgobangkosir.
Singgobangkosir.
Pala botak yang bisa disisir.
Pala botak yang bisa
Welcome to See Today Business, your go-to source for the latest economic and business updates from Indonesia, Southeast Asia, and around the globe.
Get ready for a power-packed show of insights, interviews, and analysis that will keep you ahead of the curve.
Join us Monday to Friday right at your lunch hour as we dive deep into the world of business, only on
See Today Business.
Ini tes COVID.
Iya, aku bilang hijau.
Kamu bilang biru tadi?
Iya, soalnya aku orang Madura. Kalau kamu biru kan hijau, kalau hijau kan biru.
Mau hijau apa ini?
Kenapa nama TPG ini berdiri? Kalau bahasa kek kita tuh nama panggilannya tuh lebih gampang tuh panggil Aji tuh TPG. TPG itu kan panggil tuh Mak Gendut. Resepnya turun menurun, nah, sedangkan saya baru ke generasi kedua.
Nah sekarang akhirnya udah pengurus baru, Cap.
Betul.
Lu lanjut jadi pemain?
Ya, insya Allah masih lah, masih setahun dua tahun. Kita lihat ke depannya.
Lu tuh gimana sih, apanya nih untuk menggaskan lagi fisik segala macam di kompetisi
saya yang juga,
karena,
saya juga
karena waktu itu kita benar wawancarain Loco di sini. Aha. Bahwa Liga 2 tuh lebih fisik daripada lebih fisik. Liga 1 malahan uh-huh. Bukan justru lebih santai-santai teh.
Yeah, yeah.
Jadi
pelari semua Liga 2.
Iya kan?
Pelari semua.
Ya itu lu gimana untuk bisa ngejaga? Ya,
saya juga enggak tahu sampai usia segini kok masih bisa seperti masih belum bisa nyerah gitu. Mm-hmm. Ya, mungkin karena istirahat sekarang lah. Udah cukup istirahat. Dibantu dengan latihan tambahan. kayak gym terus latihan. Ya mungkin Bang Valen kerja kan jam 7 dia, saya jam 10 udah jogging situ tipe siang-siang.
Oh, jadi gak kelihatan. Udah mulai udah rajin ya.
Udah itu.
Operasi berapa kali?
4.
4 kali operasi lu Teh. Itu lutut?
Lutut semua.
Empat-empatnya? Bayangin tuh, lutut 4 kali, kepala 3, masih main kompetitif kayak sekarang Teh. Berarti BU banget emang.
Gak ke situ dong arahnya.
Oh enggak ya? Oh, enggak ya? Enggak.